Good evening and welcome to the Board of Education meeting. I would like to start our meeting with a Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence. I'd like to ask Board Member Byron Gladden if he will lead the board in that process.
You stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thank you. We'd like to begin our meeting this evening now with a National Volunteer of the Week. We have a special proclamation for National Volunteer Week, celebrated April 7th through the 13th, in recognition of the work of our volunteers. Last year, more than 13,400 volunteers contributed nearly 452,000 hours of service to our students and schools. According to the national value of volunteer time, this work is valued at more than $11 million. Our volunteers have highly valuable impact on student and school success. They help transform the lives of students every day, academically and socially. As a district, we honor our volunteers during National Volunteer Week and encourage our community to get involved as a Guilford County School volunteer. We cannot forget about the essential role of our volunteer coordinators. On top of their everyday responsibilities, our volunteer coordinators take time to field phone calls, assist parents and community members, log volunteer hours, and organize our thousands of volunteers. During this special week, the district will celebrate our volunteer coordinators with a luncheon sponsored by the Guilford County Council of PTAs and Rice Toyota. Schools will host a variety of recognitions as well. To learn more about National Volunteer Week events and ways to get involved, visit our website and click on Connect with Guilford County Schools tab. At this time, I would like to ask the president of Guilford County Council of PTAs, Cheryl Williams, to come forward and read the proclamation for National Volunteer Week on behalf of the board. Cheryl knows how important our volunteers and volunteer coordinators are to our students and schools through her work with the Guilford County Council of PTAs. Welcome and thank you.
Thank you. And today I have with me some of my executive board of directors, the Sharetta Main, Paula Jarrell, and Christy Bryson. So again, we would like to say thank you to all of the GCS volunteers, as well as the PTA and PTSA volunteers. And so today I will be reading the proclamation. National Volunteer Week is observed for April 7th through the 13th, 2019. Whereas the entire community can inspire, equip, and mobilize individuals to take action that supports our community and public schools. And whereas the individuals, organizations, and businesses connect with the local volunteer opportunities through Guilford County Schools, 126 schools to help transform learning and life outcomes for every student. And whereas during this week, all over the nation and in Guilford County, projects will be performed and volunteers recognized for their commitment to service. And whereas our school's volunteers, coordinators, play an essential role in welcoming, organizing, and motivating our district's volunteer force of 13,400 individuals and nearly 452 service hours. And whereas our volunteers contributions are essential to the district's success. And therefore, we, Guilford County Board of Education and Guilford County Council of PTAs, hereby recognize April 7th through the 13th, 2019 as National Volunteer Week. We encourage all citizens of Guilford County to recognize those who serve and volunteer in the community and in our local public schools as we come together to make a difference. Signed this 28th day of March, 2019.
Thank you. Our volunteers, the work that you do and the contributions that you make are immeasurable. Let's give them a round of applause, please. And before you leave, we would like to ask you to come up so we can all shake your hands, because we would like to thank you as well personally.
Thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Appreciate all that you do.
Thank you for all that you do.
Thank you for all that you do.
Thank you.
Next, we will recognize our Volunteer of the Month recognition for March. Would Tiara Moraney please come to the podium at this time? And while you're doing that, I want to say a few things about you. As a recent graduate of the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, Tiara values the support of a family, teachers, and community members who have a positive influence on our youth. That's why she began volunteering at Hairston Middle School in 2016 as a mentor. With the help of another UNCG alumnus, Tiara oversees the Raise 'Em Up mentoring program and works with students in all grade levels. The program offers group mentoring, character building activities, and help with homework. Tiara organized more than 20 current UNCG students to serve as mentors in the program. She also coordinates field trips for students, such as career fairs and visits to local universities. Hairston Middle School students in the program value the academic and moral support they receive from UNCG students. Jashawn Cephas, eighth grader in the male group, says, "One thing I like about it is you are free to be yourself. We have a judgment-free zone. It is an overall fun time." Tallulah Cavanis, eighth grader in the girls group, says, "It has boosted my confidence and makes me feel like I can do better in school when I'm not concerned about what other people think. I like that I can talk to somebody. We talk about relationships, how to carry ourselves, and insecurities. The group encourages me to keep my grades up and have a positive attitude in school, so I feel like I'm doing better." Tara Reese, EC teacher who nominated Moraney, says, "Tiara encourages students to participate in the after-school program and receive the opportunity to work with caring individuals who emphasize the importance of academics and being successful in the future. It is a pleasure to recognize you as the March 2019 Guilford County Schools Volunteer of the Month. Hopefully you were presented with a $50 Visa gift card sponsored by our friends at Rice Toyota, who have donated nearly $4,000 to our dedicated volunteers since 2013. The partnership with Rice Toyota allows us to recognize a volunteer each month for their commitment to our students and schools. During the month of March, Tiara's photo has been on display at the district central offices, Hairston Middle School, and Rice Toyota Collision Center on Battleground Avenue. At this time, I'd like to ask Byron Gladden, board member, to present our certificate of recognition.
So on behalf of Guilford County Board of Education, we'd like to present you with this certificate of recognition for being the Volunteer of the Month at one of my favorite middle schools, Hairston Middle School. And at this time, if you'd like to have any words, you can use the mic here.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you. I really appreciate this recognition. You know, we never do it for the recognition, but just to see the students prosper and grow. So thank you. Could my family come up here, please?
And actually, we would like to have all of you give us the opportunity to personally thank you for all the contributions that you make to our students, schools, and community. And if any of your school, school colleagues are here as well.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Thank you for coming out. Sorry, thank you for coming out.
How are you doing?
That's your sister.
Thank you for
Thank you.
your daughter. Where do you go? Got all the generations.
Take your time. Congratulations.
Hello.
How are you, sir?
How are you?
Thank you for coming out.
Thank you for coming out and supporting amazing, amazing individuals.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming out.
How are you? Good to see you. Yeah.
It's the love.
Thank you so much, Grandpa. I know a good grandpa. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. We are now at the public comments section of our meeting. This is where we have the opportunity to hear from people who have signed up to speak. As you come to the podium, we'd like to remind you that you have 3 minutes to speak. When you have 15 seconds left, an amber light will come on. And when a red light comes on, your three minutes have expired. We would like for you to give your name and your address before your public comments. And if there are any student or personnel concerns that you have, we ask that you not communicate that via the podium, and that we have Guilford County Schools personnel here that will assist you with that. And so just let us know, and we'll have someone meet you out there with that. I don't think so. I think we'll be fine. There's a group that would like to come up together. We have Natalie Andrews, Sylvia Clapp White, Lori Kirk, and Kendall Brown. Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Natalie Higgins Andrews, 1826 Runnestone Drive, High Point, North Carolina. On behalf of Suzanne L. Morgan, president of the Greensboro Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, I bring you greetings. Also, I'd like to recognize a member of our illustrious sorority, our superintendent. I serve as the second vice president of program planning and development, with an emphasis on planning for our chapter as well as our youth initiatives. Some of our awesome youth initiatives include our Delta Academy, who include our middle school students, our Delta Gyms, who are our high school students, Project C, fifth grade. The emphasis there is on science. We also have Embody, which empowers our males for independence. They are high school age. And we have our Jabberwock participants. And we have an emphasis there on leadership as well as scholarship. And you've also just seen Tiara, who received the Volunteer of the Month. We are a public service organization, and we have emphasis on 5 programmatic thrusts. They do include economic development, educational development, international awareness and involvement, physical and mental health, political awareness and involvement. I'd like to also just thank you for continuing to support our youth and our educational event. I won't go into depth because we have our students here and they're going to talk about the program. So thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Sylvia Clapp White, 603 Cardella Drive, Greensboro, North Carolina. I'm here for 2 reasons. First, when I returned to Greensboro in 2014, I had the opportunity to attend board meetings and committee meetings. When I came back, I thought about equality. And so I learned quickly that equality was not what I should focus on. Dina Hayes taught me it was equity. That should come first, and then comes equality. So I want to thank you for that, because I had no idea until I started attending these meetings. I also want to thank Dr. Contreras, my Sora, because with her, I was also excited to see her here. However, it was the information that she provides. As a grandparent who was a substitute teacher, I had it all wrong on how to discipline a child. So I have learned a lot since I returned to Guilford County about equity and about the possibilities we have and the techniques available to us to use in educating our children. So my desire is that I hope that you all will continue to work together for all of the children in Guilford County, because they need you. I also am the social action chair for the Greensboro Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, and we have prepared for you our youth initiatives manual brochure, and it gives you some information in detail about our youth initiatives and also our sorority, and our five-point programmatic thrust is outlined by Ms. Higgins Andrews. So I thank you again for the service that you have and your dedication, and please continue to focus on all of our youth.
Good evening. I am Kendall Brown, an eighth grade student at Canoodle Middle School. I am so excited to have been able to participate in Delta Academy, which is a middle school age program for young women ages 11-14, sponsored by Greensboro Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. Delta Academy recognizes the disadvantages of young women in various communities face because of gender, income age, parental resources, despite the personal parental of girls themselves. The parental goal of the Academy is to prepare us for full participation in the 21st century world. The co-chairs, Dr. Jocelyn Bacotes and Tracy Thompson, along with other Delta Academy community members, wave.
Thank you.
Have made this experience so enjoyable for me and my friends, the other participants. Will the participants of Delta Academy, which are also GCS students, please stand and wave? Throughout this year, we have developed our leadership skills, engaged in discussions about our self-awareness, self-esteem, and self-reflection. We have learned so much about ourselves. Additionally, we gave back to our community by volunteering with the United Way and Trunk or Treat, packed stockings for the needy, which were given to the Salvation Army, participated in making crafts for Claremont Courts, and worked out with the garden who feeds thousands of family and children that are hungry. We are also fortunate just a few weeks ago to be recipients of laptop computers and form technology for the future, which will help us open doors for our future. I really enjoyed this year and know that I have grown up as a person and can be whatever I want because of the experience these ladies have given me. Thank you, ladies of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, for allowing us to participate in this program. And thank you, Superintendent Dr. Sharon Contreras and the Board of Education for recognizing us this evening. Thank you.
Good evening, I'm Lori Kirk. My address is 1211 West Hampton Drive, Greensboro, North Carolina. Okay, I'm here just to speak briefly on Project C. Project C, C stands for Science and Everyday Experiences. And this program is a STEM-based program geared towards science for fifth grade students. And we chose fifth grade students because they take the EOG in science. And we want them to know that science is fun. We want to make it exciting for them. And we want them to do well on those EOG tests and in their science careers if they choose to go that route. And currently, the program is housed at Sedgefield Elementary School. But it's not just for Sedgefield students, it's opened up to any fifth grade students in Guilford County Schools. And it's a 7-month program from October to April. So I'm not gonna talk too much, I'm gonna let you hear some from some of the participants before my time is up. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Jordan Austin.
Good evening.
From Sedgefield Elementary. I like Project C because it is a very educational experience, and the Project C program helps us have fun while learning science. In Project C, we've done forensic science, where we learned about fingerprints. We've also done chemical reactions, And my favorite cosmetic, the Cosmetic Institute project. In Cosmetic Institute, we made body scrubs, lotions, and lip balms. These are just a few reasons why I like Project C.
My name is Giovanni, and I'm from Sessual Elementary. I like Project C because we do a lot of science experiments, and it's fun and educating. And the cosmetics.
Thank you, Giovanni.
Thank you. The cosmetics, they got a chance to make gifts for their parents during Valentine's Day. That's why that was their favorite. Thank you so much.
Great, thank you. And as you're leaving, we'd like to thank the Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated for your years of volunteer hours and contributions to our schools and our students. We know we saw you all over the place during the hurricane relief efforts, and so thank you so much. Next on deck, we have Buddy Rankin Dennis, followed by Susan Teisinger. Welcome.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board and Madam Superintendent. I am Dennis Buddy Rankin. I live at 1611 Washcombe Boulevard, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27408 Irvin Park District. I am a 1971 Page graduate and on the board of the Page Alumni and Friends Association. I am here tonight in search of answers. I am here to tell you how disappointed I am with the current cafeteria situation at Page High School. I am disappointed because I believe in a board that promised us changes. I invite each and every one of you to come to visit Page during our three lunches, but please come on a day that is 41 degrees out. Pretend you are a student, you will bring your lunch, eating the bitter cold in the 10 minutes that you have left once you travel through the crowded halls at our school. And that if you're lucky, like many of at our school, maybe your family doesn't have the financial resources for you to have a packed lunch. And then you're around the school for your only source of food. Then you get to stand in line for most of your time and shovel the only meal swiftly in your mouth while standing, because there isn't enough time to room for you to sit. Let's see how you return to work and finish out your day. Now think about doing that every day for 180 days. As adults, we have all had to grind through a day without a meal. But think back to your high school days and the environment you had at mealtime. And if you say, oh, well, we had it so much worse, then I ask, why would you want to do that to kids if you could make a change? If it could have been a little bit better, why won't you want it to be? If it wasn't as tough as it is now, why wouldn't you want to make it better for providing the funding, which I understand was promise made, but promise not kept? And this is a major health issue, mental and physical. Don't worry, I don't have tonight to fill in the various studies that have been done connected what is considered adequate time for school lunch period just to meet the basic human needs of nutrition, nor do I have time to talk about the many studies connected socialization and de-stressing during lunchtime that are essential to our emotional needs. But maybe we can review at our next meeting when I have another 3 minutes. Maybe, just maybe, these words won't fall on deaf ears. Maybe this time it will be different for Page High School. I hope by seeing our Page High School family here tonight, you'll be reminded how committed we are in our community and our resolve. Family, my grandmama sit on the floor for lunch. My mother sit on the floor for lunch. Now, my time, the kids are sitting on the floor for lunch. Is this a normal trend? The setting is deplorable. Finally, if Page High School were predominantly black, we would not have this problem. We would not be here asking for assistance. The boards fail to assist, support, and simplify. But it's not what we say, Page, the board, it's what they don't say. Boy, I must be a little angry at this point. But they don't say pending. So it looks like they'll look at Paige through the audio saying, the chickens have come home to roost. Thank you.
Thank you. Susan Teisinger, followed by Leah Hendershot.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Susan Teisinger, and I live at 801 Blanton Place in Greensboro. I'm a former teacher, the mother of two Page graduates, a longtime volunteer in the schools, and a founder and leader of the Page Alumni and Friends Association. When I heard you were going to do a facility study, my response was, we've already done that. here it is. Concerned individuals and groups footed the bill for this Page High School facility assessment done by a local architect who is very familiar with the schools. In this comprehensive, this is, plan is very comprehensive and even includes blueprints for renovation. For this, we hired a Greensboro person. Earlier in 2012, a lot of the same people and groups paid for this study by theater consultants to evaluate our archaic auditorium and devise a renovation plan so that you could actually see and hear performances by our talented students. Why did we do these two things? Because we were advised in both situations that if we would come, not just complain, but come up with plans, we might be ahead of the game. And we naively believed when we kept hearing year after year, Page's time is next. Therefore, you can understand my shock and dismay when I read that $7 million from previous construction bonds had been found and was going to go to new initiative, the CTE program. This is while less than one-fourth of our student body can even fit into the cafeteria. While we're grateful for the paint, the new furniture, and the new lighting, it can't fix too small. Also, this 2015 study grades the following cafeteria areas very inadequate: walk-in cooler, walk-in freezer, prep and cooking area, holding and serving area, all negatively affecting the food that we serve our students every day. Now, the study, your study states that Page High School scored good in technology infrastructure. Well, maybe I don't know exactly what that means, but I do know that most of the teachers at Page High School who have projectors have tabletop projectors whose irreplaceable bulbs are dying by the day. And the students can barely make out the images on the screen. Presently, our Alumni and Friends Association is conducting a campaign to raise money to replace this outdated technology. But we shouldn't have to do that. We should be supplying the frills, not supplying basic needs for our school. And we're in tier two? That makes no sense. So where should this $7 million you found be going? Not be going, not to new programs. Fix what we have. Keep your promises. Give our students a decent lunch experience. Give them technology that many other schools already have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And our tradition is one of the ways to keep the meeting moving is you'll express your applause and support by doing this. We can call the next person while you're showing your support for the discussion. Riley Driver, let's see, you are Leah Hendershot, followed by Riley Driver.
Hi, good evening. Leah Hendershot. I live at 1501 Ontario Street, Greensboro, North Carolina. I am a special education teacher at Southern Guilford Middle School. I also am the mother of two kids in Guilford County Schools, one at Jamestown Middle and one at Jamestown Elementary, and the aunt of four Guilford County Schools students. I'm also the middle school executive director for GCAE. Thank you for hearing from me this evening. I wanted to let you guys know, in case you hadn't heard, that teachers plan on showing up in Raleigh on May 1st. We have five demands that we're demanding of the North Carolina General Assembly. One, provide enough school librarians, psychologists, social workers, counselors, nurses, and other health professionals to meet national standards. You may or may not be aware of the fact that in North Carolina, our student to psychologist ratio is somewhere around 1 to 2100. The national standard is 1 to 700, right? In my school, we have a nurse half a day on Wednesday. The national standard is a full-time nurse in every single school building, right? We know, I know that the board, as well as Dr. Contreras, supports our schools and wants what's best for our kids. And I also believe that you know that that's not what we currently have in our schools, is what's best for our students and our educators. We also are asking for a $15 minimum wage for school personnel, 5% raise for all staff, including teachers, admin, and a 5% cost of living adjustment for retired folks. We want you them to expand Medicaid to improve the health of our students, their families, as well as most of our classified staff who don't qualify currently for Medicaid, but who desperately need health care and don't currently have it. We want them to reinstate retiree health benefits eliminated by the General Assembly in 2017, as well as restore advanced degree compensation stripped by the General Assembly in 2013. Those last two, to me, seems ridiculous that we ever lost them in the first place, right? Our people should be paid a livable wage, a respectable wage. Our educators should be paid those things. And I would urge every single educator in Guilford County, as well as the rest of the state of North Carolina, to put your personal day in for May 1st if you haven't already. Building leaders from around Guilford County report to me on a daily basis the number of confirmed people that they have out in their buildings, and we're at over 700 people currently confirmed by building leaders across Guilford County schools. Educators overwhelmingly want these demands to be met. These are bare minimum things that we need for our schools and for our kids. We need so much more than these five things, right? But at the bare minimum, the General Assembly should be willing to give this to us, because I know that my kids deserve it. I know that my coworkers deserve it. I would urge Dr. Contreras to consider the fact that the sooner we close schools, the faster our parents and families and community members can plan for what they're going to do on May 1st. And so if we have enough people that have put in a personal day that the schools are not operational, then we should give our families and communities time to plan for what they're going to be doing on May 1st and maybe for a few days after. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Riley Driver, followed by Amy Harrison.
Hi. My name is Riley Driver. My address is 504 Houston Street, 27401. I'm an English learner teacher, a teacher of English learners. I love my job. I work at Jamestown Middle, which is one of the strongest schools in the county. But even though I work in one of the newest buildings with some of the highest test scores and the lowest teacher turnover, even for us, the gap between what we have and what our students need is still unacceptable. I'm here to urge you to support our fight on May 1st, because I know you see these problems too, and you have to see that the only way to get change is to fight for it. I'm not going to tell you anything that you don't know already, but I've noticed that as educators, we have to be flexible to make do with less, to smile through struggle so often that we can end up getting used to things that we and our students should never have to get used to. I don't want to get used to telling sick or injured kids that no, the nurse isn't here today. I don't ever want to get comfortable with the fact that many of our families don't have access to decent health care in the first place. I don't want to get used to meeting a new custodian or substitute custodian every week or two because we don't pay our staff enough to stay, let alone to live. I don't want to get used to my English learners missing the bus because they didn't understand one of the five or six or seven bus changes due to driver shortages. This afternoon we had eight. I don't want to get used to emails informing us that entire busloads of children will be missing the first part of their instructional day again. I don't want our students to get used to no one having enough time to genuinely help them through trauma, poverty, or mental illness. I don't want to get used to the achievement gap, or the discipline gap, or the wealth gap, or the health gap. I don't want to get used to seeing good educators leave because the job is more than a human being can do and pays less than a family can live on. I don't want our students to get used to the idea that even the very people who make education possible don't deserve a living wage. And I know you all know all these things and you don't want to get used to those either. But even in one of GCS's strongest schools, this is my daily experience. We are in this together, students, families, educators, and you all. Educators are ready to go fight for what our schools need. Please stand with us together in this fight. Last year, GCS decided to close on May 16th, a day that gave me the hope that I needed to stay in my job. We urge you to support us and acknowledge this by making the call to close schools on May 1st as soon as you can, so that our families have time to make the necessary arrangements. We are in this together. It's been long enough. It's been enough getting used to and enough making do. It's time for action. Thank you.
Thank you. Amy Harrison, followed by Jamie Yee.
Hi, my name is Amy Harrison, and my address is 7385 Wood Springs Drive in Whitsitt. I'm a special education teacher at Reedy Fork Elementary School. I'm here tonight to share with you why I have put in a personal day and will attend the Advocacy Day on May 1st. One of the issues we are focusing on is providing a $15 minimum wage for classified employees and a 5% raise for all support staff, teachers, administrators, and a 5% cost of living adjustment for our retirees. I've been teaching 19 years and just recently was able to quit my second job. Most school employees, whether they are certified or classified, work two and sometimes three jobs to survive. When politicians don't provide our employees a living wage and decent benefits, they create unnecessary havoc in the school environment our students depend on. To give our students a high quality education, we also need to provide the basics. And that means treating all employees with the value they deserve. You've already heard the five issues that we are focusing on that day, and that I believe that they align with the issues that are on the Guilford County Schools legislative agenda. I invite each one of you to advocate with us on May 1st for strong students, strong schools, and strong communities. Thank you for your service to the students and staff of Guilford County Schools.
Thank you. William Yee, followed by Todd Warren. Jamie Yee, followed by Todd Warren.
Good evening. My name is Jamie Yee. I live in 4018 Kenterwood Drive, Greensboro, and North Carolina, 27410. Since my previous speakers actually covered most of the five issues, I'm going to actually focus on one of those issues, which is lack of school counselors and health professionals and school nurses and librarians. So I think my story will be really helpful, how practically it impacts our students on a daily basis. So my name is Jamie E, and I'm a special education teacher at Southeast Middle School. Tonight, I'm here to advocate for my students with disabilities. Most of my students have communication issues. Most of the cases, we are able to receive immediate and appropriate services from our speech pathologist. Most of my students have sensory processing disorder. Again, most of the cases, we're able to get help from our occupational therapist. Some of my students have physical disability. Fortunately, we can receive immediate and appropriate service from our physical therapist in our district. Some of my students have behavior issues. Most of the cases, I can figure out what triggers are and how to prevent them. I can say that those behaviors are triggered by lack of communication and or their primarily disability. Lately, it has been observed that there are lots of severe and aggressive behaviors. Unfortunately, we cannot figure out those triggers. Those triggers are unknown. Those behaviors hurt students every day. Those behaviors hurt staff every day. Currently, those behaviors do not belong in any category of the related services like OT, speech, or PT. People then ask me, do we have any school professionals who can handle this issue? Yes. School counselors, school nurses, school psychologists, and mental health professionals or behavior professionals are the ones. Do we have enough? Definitely no. I do not feel that I have to talk about all the statistic numbers that here tonight, such as like how many students and how many schools each professional should cover and what is the national average. I'm here tonight as a classroom teacher who deals with this issue every day to tell you one clear thing. We need more resources. We need more professionals that can help my students effectively. I put my day in for May 1st and I'm gonna support my students. And thank you.
Thank you. Todd Warren, followed by Marcy Matchett.
Good evening, Superintendent and Board. My name is Todd Warren. I'm at 1043 South Josephine Boyd Street. You've heard from a host of educators tonight about a May 1st event in Raleigh. And I'm here to invite you to go with us. I know last year when we went out for May 16th, there was some hesitancy among some board members and other leaders in the community about why would we be going to Raleigh? Why don't we do this on another day? Today, Superintendent Johnson urged us to do on a day that school was not in session. Well, we've done that. We do that routinely. We've done it for years and years and years and years. But last year we got some folks' attention, and I think you can see some distinct results right now in a notable absence of bad legislation coming out of the North Carolina General Assembly. for years now, we've just been fighting off and playing defense for some of the worst legislation. And some, even some of the bad bills that we see coming forward right now, we know they're getting no traction. They're going to die in committee somewhere. That was the work that we did. We took away some of the bad actors in November and sent a clear message that you need to fully fund our schools and have some research-based policy led by public school educators. You need to listen to the voices of our teachers. So I'm asking you that you trust our teachers, that you trust our public school workers. And I shared with you our new business item that NCAE passed this past week. And NCAE is the largest professional organization representing teachers in North Carolina. We met with over 500 public school educators from 80 different counties, and they voted overwhelmingly to pass that resolution. There's some big ticket items on there. But really what it represents, much like our building study represents, is a lack of funding over the last 20 years. We're just asking for some bare bones basics. And I think when you see that we're asking for an across the board raise of 5% for all staff and get to a $15 minimum, that's pretty reasonable for people that are making less than they made in 2008, once you take into account healthcare costs and inflation. The rest are student-centered. Talking about librarians, psychologists, expanding Medicaid for children. A colleague of mine in Forsyth County put together a map today correlating the school testing grades, which we don't like, I'm not upholding those, but the low student testing grades with students and counties that don't have adequate access to health care that Medicaid expansion would improve. Medicaid expansion costs North Carolina almost nothing. For us as public school educators who have seen rising healthcare costs, that would lower our healthcare premiums. So I urge you to stand with us, to be bold, to be brave, just as these educators here tonight are being brave and letting you know that they're putting their personal day in for May 1st, and not to listen to the rhetoric of this hurting kids. The last 15 to 20 years of public school funding is what has hurt kids. I ask you to stand with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Marcy Matchett, I hope I'm saying your name right, followed by Ron Surgeon.
You got it right.
That's good.
I'm Marcy Matchett. I reside at 5201 Ainsworth Drive, Greensboro, North Carolina. I am a fifth grade teacher at Jesse Wharton Elementary, and I want to start with a question. Who is important to the success of a student? Teachers, of course. A principal, certainly. Assistant principal, absolutely. Parents, without a doubt. Specialists, no question. But what about school psychologists, cafeteria workers, custodians, nurses, counselors, social workers? According to current budgets, not really, but data says otherwise. Relationships matter, but they aren't a budget item. School psychologists, students can't be successful with little or no support for their mental health issues. We have one psychologist for every 2,100 students. It should be one for every 700. Cafeteria workers. Students can't be successful if they're hungry, and we need to provide them with breakfast and lunch. These employees connect with our students daily, 180 days or even more for extended year, and they build special relationships with our kids. Custodians. Students can't be successful if their learning environments are not clean and in working conditions. Our custodians do far more than that. They develop relationships with our students as well. Nurses, our students can't be successful if they are sick or have medical issues. Classroom teachers are not qualified to make medical decisions or treatments. Nurses are a vital need in each school every day because we know that students don't have health issues only one day per week. Counselors. Students can't be successful if they don't have resources for their social and emotional health. These include counseling, focus groups, and crisis management. According to the American School Counselor Association, there should be a ratio of one counselor to every 250 students. Social workers. Students can't be successful if they don't have someone to fight for their welfare of their community, both at home and at school. Social workers provide support and assistance with attendance, students' mental health, and the vital home-to-school connection. Their relationships with students are necessary for student success, and there should be a ratio of one social worker
to every 250 students. So therefore, the answer to the question, who is important to the success of a student, is anyone who touches the lives of a student, which is all of us. And this is why we need funding for all of our educational professionals and why I will be in Raleigh on May 1st. Thank you.
Thank you. Ron Surgeon, followed by Gina Allam.
Good evening, Dr. Contreras, Chairwoman, Ms. Dina Hayes, and Guilford County School System Board members. My name is Ron Surgeon. My address is 6806 Russellwood Court, Pleasant Garden, North Carolina. I want to start by saying, I sit in this chair, you people sitting in right now, for the town of Pleasant Garden. I'm an elected official in the town of Pleasant Garden. Been doing that in excess of 20 years. You know, that's a pretty long time. Okay. So evidently I must be doing something right. So that's my history. But I want to say, I'm here to speak on behalf of classified employees for Guilford County Schools. And also I want to say too, that I support everything our teachers have said. That when I was in the first grade at Rena Bullitt Elementary School out in Pleasant Garden, which is no longer exists, the principal name was Mr. Holt, and he told us then the most important person in this country was a teacher. You know why? Because teachers teach presidents. So that's why I support what our teachers need to be successful. Okay, on the flip side of that, as a classified employee, we are essential to the system too. Every day, if classified employees were not available for service, that's what we do. We do service. The doors weren't open. The doors were not open. So how important is that? The $15 per hour livable wage is important, but in my opinion, that's only beginning. You know, $15 in probably average full time is 30 hours a week. So if you figure $15 is 30 hours a week, and you only work 10 months a year, so is that reasonable? Well, it's better than what it is now. $15 be better than what it is now. So like I say, I want to say that is the beginning. So we encourage this GCS Board of Education to have dialogue with our Guilford delegation to make sure the board is on board with it and make sure we are dialoguing with our representatives the importance of seeing everything that we have requested to be approved by the legislature. And there's no negotiation. This is beyond negotiating. This is what must happen. So I want to say thank you in advance.
Thank you, Mr. Surgeon. Gina Allam, followed by Mark Carley.
Excuse me, if I may, can I speak with you? I put my paper in.
Oh, you did? What's your name? Yvonne? Yes, you're next, but I'll go ahead and put you if you don't mind. Okay.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Yvonne Sutton, P.O. Box 953, Greensboro, North Carolina. And on behalf of classified employees, we have been speaking with the School Nutrition Services campaign of Raise the Wage about our cafeteria and school nutrition employees. And I sent some emails out, and some of you may not have gotten them, about School Lunch Hero Day. There's been conversation going on that our cafeteria workers are not being recognized. And School Lunch Hero Day is a national day on May 3rd, 2019. Between preparing healthy food, adhering to strict nutrition standards, navigating student food allergies, and offering services with a smile, the school nutrition employees have a lot on their plate. And to celebrate their hard work and commitment, there's a day which is celebrated called School Lunch Hero Day on May 3rd. And we're asking the Guilford County Schools to recognize our hard work school nutrition employees on that day. Also, there's a book called The Lunch Lady, and there's like a series of 11 of them. And if we can drop everything and read about the lunch lady and let them know how important the lunch lady is in the lives of our children, that would be great. And I'm asking you all to recognize May 3rd, 2019 as School Lunch Hero Day and get the schools on board, because there have been conversations about school personnel mistreating cafeteria personnel, but we all work for Gifford County Schools. And it's time to show love, you know, towards one another. And I'm Chairman, Mr. Surgeon, and I'm the co-chair of the school nutrition campaign. And I want to share this with
if you just give it to Ms. Hall.
Oh, right, okay.
So make sure we get it. Thank you.
Whoever, I'm sorry. Been a long day. You know, yes, thank y'all so kindly. Y'all doing a great work. Keep up the good work. And we know great things are coming to Gifford County. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Gina Allen, followed by Mark Carley.
Good evening, Board of Education. I am Gina Allen. I live at 5105 Bodie Lane, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27455. I'm a parent of a senior at Page High School, and I have a rising freshman that's due to Page High School. My daughters have been attending the public schools here in Guilford County since they were in kindergarten, and I have been an active volunteer in their schools since 2006. To say that I speak before you tonight frustrated and disappointed is an understatement. In a meeting 2 years ago, a group of concerned Page parents and supporters were specifically told by Chair Alan Duncan and our Board of Ed rep, Darlene Garrett, that Page would be a priority when funding was available. We all understood this to be the next bond, only to find out yet again we are being passed up. While $7 million of found money is going to a new career and technical initiative, the $7 million leftover money they found was from previous construction bonds and should not be used for new initiatives. It should be used for its original purpose. $7 million would easily solve the issues at Page's cafeteria. We certainly support programs that will prepare our children for the workplace and for future careers, but this is not what the money was intended for, nor what was voted on by the taxpayers. The Page cafeteria remains inadequate due to age and size. Your recent facility study suggests moving 300 students to a new school. We assert this is not the solution. Allocating the appropriate funds towards a new cafeteria is the only solution. In our opinion, assigning Page to phase two of this facility study pushes funding towards our school out for another 10 years. And that's if and when a new bond for school construction passes favorably. What their criteria and method of scoring does is put Page in tier two of upgrades and renovations, which would put us years away from major improvements, since tier one is really just a thought. Page parents, friends, and alumni continue to raise money and make purchases and improvements that Guilford County schools should be paying for. Technology, additional seating for lunch, a new teacher's lounge, and improvements to the library. The list goes on and on and on. So I ask you, why do we have leadership that doesn't believe in following through on their word? Why do we have leadership that agrees to inequitable distribution of funds? And why do we have a school and the only one in Guilford County with the shortest lunch because of a facility that cannot house the number of students that it has and has had for many years? I am asking for leadership to honor their word. I'm asking for leadership to follow through as previously agreed. I appreciate your time this evening, and I hope these words and questions will be answered and addressed swiftly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mark Carley, our final speaker.
I feel unprepared. Everybody else had a speech. I'm just here. And by the way, this wasn't on my agenda, but I'm completely with every one of you teachers, and I think on May 1st, my kids would love to go to the zoo or to the mountains or anywhere else. The fact that I worked at Papa John's as a general manager and I made more than most of these teachers did in this room is ridiculous. So something's got to change. Which brings me to the actual topic that I'm here for. Do I need to hit anything? Cool. All right. All right. So on the 18th of March, we as a county heard about an issue at Ferndale Middle School where there was a threat of an assault against that school. possible school shooting in effect for that day that was found out about around 11 o'clock at night that Monday, the 18th. On Tuesday, we, as parents, had no idea. This was something that the school knew about. This is something they talked to the High Point Police Department about. And this is something that they chose not to inform the parents of, even though there was not an all clear done until later Tuesday afternoon. So on Tuesday morning, when my fiance and I were dropping our daughter off at school at Ferndale, with no adult supervision outside, about 20 sixth graders heading into the sixth grade entrance, standing on the stairway, even though we were told there was more emergency personnel put in place, we saw none at 8:30 a.m. with my own eyes, okay? So my issue is, it's not that the school did not follow actual protocol. We've had a meeting now with Mr. Andrew Jaspers, who's the director of emergency safety for the county. We've had a meeting with the school principal. We've had a meeting with the SRO there and countless other people last Friday. And all great people. We absolutely love the school. They do great things for our children. I couldn't tell you what the psychologist has done for our daughter. Honestly, she never wanted to even go to school in sixth grade, and now as an eighth grader, absolutely loves the place. So thank you. And thank you to everybody at Ferndale. Amazing school. But whatever protocol that you all have in place for something like this is wrong if the parents are not involved, okay? We have the opportunity to save our children. We have the opportunity, even though this could have been a rumor, which it ended up being, we have the opportunity to make that decision to keep our children safe and keep them home. Instead, if one child got shot, this is an entirely different situation, okay? I was a Marine. I was in for 5 years. I understand I could be on a rooftop somewhere 500 yards and pick off anybody. Not that I'm going to do that, but other people will. Okay, 2 days before this, we had a issue at a park where somebody opened fire on teenagers, like 13 teenagers. That person still isn't caught. But 2 days after that, we have a threat against one of the schools and we did nothing. That's just not right. We need to keep our parents involved. We need to alert all parents if any situation like this happens. And you need to put that in our hands on whether we're gonna protect our children or not. It's not up to you if they're not at the school. If they're at the school, do everything you need to. And we appreciate that. But no matter what, the parents need to know, period.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are now at approval of the agenda. Is there a motion? Yes.
Like to take a point of personal privilege, if I may?
That's fine.
Okay. I'm going to read a statement that was supposed to be read at the last meeting with the board and the county commissioners, but for reasons that are still unclear to me, it was not. There is a major omission in the MGT facility study in that it does not recognize the serious overcrowding at Page High School and the conditions the students have endured far longer than necessary. The cafeteria is woefully undersized given the size of the student body. Every day, the custodian is forced to drag out 20 or more tables to place in the foyer adjacent to the auditorium, which is a long way from the cafeteria, especially when you have only 25 minutes for lunch. And every day he must break down the tables, return them to storage, and clean the area. On rainy days, you will find students sitting on the floor eating their lunches because even the overflow space is grossly inadequate. 2 years ago, I sat in a meeting with Superintendent Contreras, Chairman Duncan, and other GCS facilities employees and several concerned Page representatives. In that meeting, a commitment was made that Page was a top priority and the issues with the cafeteria would be addressed when funding became available. The Page community at large, who are joined by many citizens of the county, have a very good memory, perhaps better than ours. I support the position of the Page community that the commitments made must be kept. In addition to the practical aspects of inadequate facilities, As leaders of GCS, we are dealing with the issues of transparency and trust. I'm asking that this board, by a show of hands, support the needs of the Page High School by making the cafeteria a top priority, and that the board show their support of the superintendent and board representatives in those commitments from that meeting of 2 years ago.
Darlene, I don't think that's appropriate to ask the board to make that kind of a commitment. I think it involves a much deeper discussion. I know that we're all concerned. I'm a Page graduate. My son's a Page graduate. I don't think that any of us are insensitive to those needs. I just don't think it's appropriate to ask people to take a position without having a deeper discussion about this. Well, so I just wanted to say that.
It's been languishing too long, Dina.
I agree. Yeah. I wasn't in that meeting. I don't remember having that conversation. I just think we need to have greater discussion. I bet every board member here could bring their school's facility needs to the board that are urgent. And I hear you, and I hear the Page community as well. So thank you. We're at approval of the agenda. Is there a motion?
Thank you. I'd like to make that motion that we move the resolution to the regular agenda.
So can we get the approval of the agenda first, and then we'll have, will we make changes after we have approved the agenda? Are you talking about the consent agenda? So can we approve the agenda first, and then we'll go to the consent agenda?
Excuse me. The agenda was changed, and I'm not sure what was removed. There were some items late.
Dr. Contreras, I think that, would you say what was removed, the revised agenda? That should be the one that you have.
Instructional.
Well, I have four. I'm not sure which one's correct.
I think the one Lisa sent last, where the instructional contracts were removed.
Instructional contracts.
And new leaders.
There were a lot of questions that came within the last 24 hours that require a lot more investigation into those. And so we can talk about board member questions about agenda items, getting to the superintendent earlier so that they have time to go through those, because multiple ones were coming in from multiple board members at the last
time. Is the one that was in the lobby correct? Okay, I'm good.
Okay. So we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor of the agenda, say aye. Any opposed? Okay, so now we're at the consent agenda. So is there something, Kim, you wanted to move on the consent agenda?
Yes. I wanted to move our joint resolution to the consent agenda.
You want to remove, you want to move the joint resolution, which is under action item, to the consent agenda?
Yes.
All right, so
we're going to move the resolution on urgent support of, is that the one we're talking about, or?
That is if the if people vote to do that.
Rebuild America School Act, just move it to the consent agenda.
So we would vote on that?
Yes.
I guess first, the motion is to move.
So it's an action item. To move the action item, the joint resolution urging support for the Build America School Act to the consent agenda.
Yes. That's my motion.
So there's a motion and there's a second.
Let's vote.
So we're not voting on the consent agenda, we're just voting to move that to the consent agenda.
Right.
Okay. Okay, so now we're at the consent agenda. Dr. Contreras?
All right. So is it on the consent agenda?
Yes.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. The consent agenda includes several items. Those items are the personnel report, the 2018-19 budget amendment, class size update and waiver requests, summer enrichment plan approval, Education Innovation and Research Grant, Management Print Services Contract, and the resolution, Urgent Support for the Rebuild America School Act of 2019.
All right, members, please vote. We can go one by one and do that. Okay. So we'll start with Anita.
No on A, yes on the rest.
Me?
Darlene?
Oh, no on A and yes on the rest. Okay, Byron? Consent.
Oh, sorry. Yes, pull D. Yes to all but D, pull D.
So you're voting no on D?
Yes, no on D. Well, no, I'm voting to pull D for discussion.
Okay.
Pull it.
We have voted on the consent agenda as it was.
Oh, of course, I'm sorry. Yes to all, sorry.
So yes on all?
Yes to all.
Dina, no on F and G. Yes on the rest?
One second.
F and G.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
I know, I'm not sure. Excuse me. Yes on all.
Kim was on yes on all. Dina was no
We're
on
having
F
to write
and
a
G.
Lot, so if you guys could be patient and move
I'm sorry. So G, the joint resolution, move to G. Okay. Winston, yes on all. Linda?
Did I say yes?
Yes. Pat?
At this point.
No on E. Yes to the rest.
And Diane?
Yes.
Okay, so let me see if I have this. Item A passes a vote of 7-2. The rest of the agenda passes 8-1 on F and G, and then 8-1 on item E, right?
I didn't get it. Oh, E was
all right.
Yes, okay, that is
yes.
Right.
Yes.
We believe that's right.
Yes. And I have it here if we need to go back over that again. We are now at reports from the chair, and I would like to say a couple of things. Good evening to the Guilford County Schools for receiving the Best Communities for Music Education designation from the NAM Foundation for its outstanding commitment to music education. This is the second consecutive year the National Association of Music Merchants has honored us with this national recognition. The award recognizes the fact that we are leading the way with learning opportunities as outlined in the Every Student Succeeds Act, known as ESSA. ESSA recommends music and arts as important elements of a well-rounded education for all children. March is National Music in Our Schools Month. Appropriately, Guilford County Schools Arts Department sent approximately 12,000 third and fourth graders to Grimsley High the past few weeks to experience the Greensboro Symphony. I am so grateful to Guilford County's schools 58 partners and our dedicated teachers and staff who work to bring music to our students every day. Student studies have shown that participating in arts education can boost student achievement and help close the opportunity gap between socioeconomic groups, and we are committed to keeping those opportunities in our school. This is also a good time to recognize Teresa Kennedy, choral director at Jamestown Middle, for being recognized as Music Teacher of Excellence by the Country Music Foundation, Association Foundation in Nashville. She was one of only 10 teachers in the country to receive the award. We would also like to recognize our Director of Academically Gifted Services, Debrell Touré. Debrell was recently named President of the North Carolina Association for the Gifted and Talented. In this role, she will represent the state at various national events aimed at addressing gaps in gifted education. During the same conference that appointed Debrell to her new position, Sedalia's academically gifted teacher, Terry Kennedy, was named the 2019 Outstanding Teacher of the Gifted, and Ragsdale Jr. Logan Smith received the Leadership Through Service Award for reestablishing a robotics club at Millis Road Elementary. We are all very proud of you, and this concludes my remarks. We are now at a report from the superintendent.
Thank you. I want to thank those of you who attended our 2019 GCS Choice Showcase on March 13. It was a great success with more than 5,800 people attending. At some points, our clickers gave out, so we think as many as 6,000 to 7,000 may actually have attended, which could make this fair our largest ever in terms of attendance. Our expanded JROTC programs were a great addition to the showcase this year, as well as our 6 new signature career and technical education academies that will prepare more students for college and high-skill, high-wage careers in advanced manufacturing, STEM fields, healthcare, and other growth industries in our state, region, and nation. This was all in addition to the more than 50 other magnet and high school options, like our 9 middle and early colleges and themed academies that serve students from pre-kindergarten through high school with dual enrollment in local 2- and 4-year colleges and universities. Applications for all choice programs are due by midnight Friday, April 5th. To assist parents with our new online application system called SchoolMint, all schools will open a computer lab or space in the Media Center tomorrow, Friday, March 29th, during our planned teacher workday. Schools will be open to parents who need assistance with the online application from 9 a.m. until 4 p.m. Staff will be available to help guide parents through the new application process at all schools. Next week is our final choice application week, so in anticipation of the April 5th deadline next Friday, we will provide access to technology and/or assistance for parents who need help with completing their child's online application. Monday, April 1st through Thursday, April 4th at the school sites. As a reminder, the deadline for submitting applications online for all magnet, high school choice options, and choice programs is midnight, Friday, April 5th. We encourage parents to take advantage of the additional assistance we are offering. We know that new processes can be challenging, and we want to provide the space and staff to ensure that parents get what they need for their students. Board members Kim Irby, Linda Wellborn, and Byron Gladden join me in Washington, D.C. on March 16th through 19th for the annual Great City Schools Legislative and Policy Conference. We had the opportunity to visit Capitol Hill and meet with the legislative aides for Congresswoman Alma Adams and Congressman Mark Walker and Ted Budd. I am sure Board Member Wellborn will give an update during her comment period. We want to thank Congressman Mark Walker for joining us in Greensboro to visit 2 of our schools. He took time to speak with Northeast Middle School students after they wrote to him about the condition of their school facility. We took a tour of the school along with the principal, Jamie King, and students Joshua Gray, Isabella Reyes, and Azia Koulibaly. The condition of our schools is an issue that needs to be addressed at the local, state, and national levels, and I am so proud of our students who are joining in the effort to improve school facilities across our district and nation. Congressman Walker also visited Smith High School to see the condition of the facilities there as well, and to thank and honor the 3 heroes responsible for quickly apprehending an armed intruder, LaShanti Hines, Patrick Jordan, and Officer D.K. Evans, who each received a certificate of special congressional recognition and a U.S. flag that has flown over Capitol Hill. Speaking of the new academies, I was honored to share GCS's plans for CTE programs at the City Help of the Triad Community Gathering on March 19th. The topic was tomorrow's workforce, and I was able to reiterate our goal of providing equitable choices of high-quality education through CTE pathways. I am grateful to Bishop Adrian Starks, who hosted the event, and the Board of Directors of City Help, who organized the event and included me in that discussion. And lastly, the new issue of Ignite magazine is available and focuses on the many arts education opportunities in GCS. Of the students enrolled in arts education, 100% graduate from high school, 99% are college bound, 99% are also enrolled in honors, AP, or IB courses, and 97% are involved in sports, clubs, or student government. The investment is worth it. I want to thank GEA for their continued sponsorship of this informative magazine. Copies are available in the lobby, and we have placed copies for our board members at your seats. I'd like to ask our legislative committee chair to please read the resolution urging support for the Rebuild America School Act of 2019.
The resolution for the Rebuild America School Act of 2019. GCS is urging support for the rebuild. Whereas the Guilford County Board of Education oversees the public schools in Guilford County and serves over 72,000 students in 126 schools over 627 square miles. And whereas the Guilford County Board of County Commissioners is statutorily charged with providing facilities for the public schools and has worked with Guilford County Schools to consider ways to meet needs of Guilford County Schools. And whereas the air quality, water quality, and other environmental issues inherent in the buildings throughout our 126 sites that are an average of 56 years old create substantial challenges and financial burdens for the maintenance and upkeep. And whereas increasing demands for STEAM education and career technical education programs with 21st century learning to prepare students for college and careers requires equipment and technology to meet those demands. And whereas Guilford County Schools and the Guilford County Board of County Commissioners have been working together on a collaborative effort to assess the infrastructure of the schools in Guilford County and to make a plan to upgrade, improve, repair, redesign the facilities so that every child in Guilford County can be educated in classrooms free of environmental, structural, or logistical impediments and equipped with the technology and equipment required for effective learning. And whereas estimates of the cost of completing the facilities upgrades recommended in the most recent study are approximately $1,500,000,000. Guilford County Schools and the Guilford County Board of County Commissioners believe that the need to improve facilities is urgent and funding the improvements will require many resources of revenue. And whereas Congress has acknowledged the financial burdens and challenges facing public schools and has introduced legislation titled Rebuild America's Schools Act of 2019, H.R. 865, which would provide significant funding through grants available to states and public schools with a particular focus on children living in poverty. And whereas Guilford County Schools and the Guilford County Board of County Commissioners believe that the Rebuild America School Act would be a great benefit to the citizens of Guilford County in that it would provide, through a grant-based process, an opportunity to improve schools and infrastructure in Guilford County schools most impacted by poverty. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Guilford County Board of Education joins with the Guilford County Board of County Commissioners to urge its congressional representatives to support and fully fund the Rebuild America School Act of 2019 for the benefit of the students and citizens of Guilford County.
We are now at our first report, and we have our goal four, EVOS by subject baseline presentation. I believe Dr. Penny is approaching the microphone for this presentation. Good evening, Dr. Penny and company.
Dr. Contreras, Chairwoman Hayes, and board members, it's a pleasure to be here this evening. We're going to talk about more KPIs. So these KPIs are under goal four, which says by 2022, we will increase by 50% the number of schools that exceed growth. And the specific KPIs under that goal are KPI 4.1, which is to meet or exceed the yearly district value added growth measure across grades in EOG reading 3 through 8. KPI 4.2 is to meet or exceed the yearly district value-added growth measure across grades in EOG math 4 through 8. And KPI 4.3 to meet or exceed the yearly district value-added growth measure in EOC math 1. We have been through these slides. I'm going to go through them very quickly, where we explain the difference between proficiency and growth. Proficiency is scoring at a specific achievement level on a specific test at one point in time. So to be proficient on any one of our state EOGs or EOCs, a student must score at achievement level 3, 4, or 5. Growth is the change in test scores from one point in time to another. So how much students have improved or not from one year to the next. And this graph just shows that you can have students who are proficient. As you notice, the student in blue is proficient at all three points in time, but clearly not growing. The student in red, student B, is clearly growing, but hasn't quite reached the proficiency level. So that demonstrates the difference between what we're assessing here. So we know that students generally grow or develop from year to year. And what the value-added analyses do is they examine how that growth varies from teacher to teacher, school to school, and district to district. So EVAS predicts or estimates how well a student is going to do on a particular test. And then it looks at, compares the prediction to the progress the student's made. And if the student has made more progress than we expect, we say that student has exceeded growth. If they make about the progress we would expect, they have met growth. And if they don't make the progress we would expect, we say they did not meet growth. When they have exceeded that growth, we say that the teacher has added value to that student. So student achievement basically assesses where we are, and it's highly correlated with demographic factors. We know that our proficiencies are highly correlated with our poverty in our district. Student growth looks at how far have we come, and it is highly dependent on what happens in the classroom and as a result of schooling and not on demographic factors. So now to the KPIs. So EVAS growth is assessed in each subject area. So we get growth calculations for every EOG subject and grade, reading 3 through 8, math 4 through 8, and science 5 and 8. Growth is also calculated on our EOC subjects, that is English 2, Biology, Math 1, and for the first time this year, we have growth calculated on Math 3. So the KPI for reading 3 through 8, across grades 3 through 8, we have exceeded growth in reading for all 3 years that are reported in the most recent report we got from EVAS. So for 2016, 17, and 18, when you look across grades 3 through 8 in reading, we have exceeded growth every year. And you can see on the far right of this chart, blue indicates that we have exceeded growth. And there is a measure for each of the past 3 years, and then there is a 3-year average measure, which also shows that we have exceeded growth. When we look at math 4 through 8, across grades 4 through 8, we have exceeded growth in 16 and 17, but we did not meet growth in 2018. And you can see that on this chart. The 3-year average says we have exceeded growth, but we did not meet growth in 2018. For math 1, we exceeded growth in 16 and 17, and we met growth in 2018. Again, you can see here, we exceeded in 16-17, met growth in 18, and the 3-year average says that we exceeded growth for Math 1. So when we look at the status of these KPIs, we would say that at this point we have met the KPI for each of the past 3 years in reading. We have met the KPI for 2016 and 17 in math. We feel that we are on track to meet that KPI in 2019 because of the new math curriculums that have been implemented at both elementary and middle schools. And for Math 1, we have met the KPI for each of the past 3 years.
Mm-hmm. Linda?
On the first slide, I mean, what we're looking at is all grades going across. So we're looking at the current third grade, current fourth grade, current. So they're not the same kids going up, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
For any one year, it's all the students that were in those
grades. In that school. So, mm-hmm. Correct. So in looking at the first slide, I am concerned about our third grade reading scores. Because third grade for 3 years has had a negative performance.
For 2 years. The bottom one is the 3 year average.
Thank you. For 2 years it has had, and then the 2016 it was flat totally. It had zero, so it was just flat. My concern is that that's a key or gateway year. So those kids next year will be our fourth graders. And generally we know that if our third graders are not reading on the grade level, that we will have that same kind of outcome maybe in fourth grade unless we do something about it. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes. Now, one thing I would point out, if you look at 2017, third grade reading, we did not meet growth. Those children went to fourth grade in 2018, and they did meet growth in when they moved on to fourth grade.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So you go down diagonal. Right, diagonal to follow a cohort of students.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, that was so one concern.
We can hope that we will see the same thing with last year's third graders who will move up to fourth grade.
Okay. I'll just add a couple things on that too. When we look, one of the things that we're doing as a result of this is looking at our data in kindergarten through second grade as well, and then analyzing the impact of the CKLA implementation. So this is the second year of that. So we're looking at those trends as well, because I personally don't like to see a cohort, you know, a different cohort every single year in third grade going down. So we're analyzing some trends in that. And we do believe and see some results of the CKLA implementation, even though it's the second year of implementation, and think that it will eventually impact that third grade growth analysis.
Okay. And then my other would be on the math, where the eighth graders have gone down every year or 2 years in a row. That's not, I'm trying to add that third and that's a sum. So for 2 years, the eighth grade, we recognize that 2018 was not a great year for us, that we didn't meet growth, but also that eighth grade year has consistently not been doing well either, kind of like what we saw in the third grade.
Right, and that's, I think, where we become doubly concerned is when we see proficiency drop and not meeting expected growth. So eighth grade is a good example of that. So we did see proficiency drop there, and we saw the growth and not meeting growth. A non-example of that is where we saw math one proficiency drop. However, we exceeded we met growth. It's on the next slide. We met growth in math one. So that is a little bit of indicators of saying that, well, maybe those math one students came in lower, but they met growth, and maybe that's why proficiency is down. So you're exactly right, Linda.
And I remember asking that question somewhere back.
You did. So they are exactly
right. Question, and that was your answer, right.
So you're exactly right about that. And I think that this is kind of screaming, especially when you look at 2018 across the board, fourth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, it's screaming the tightness of the instructional resources that we have. So this is the first year that we've implemented the open up resources. We have the job embedded coaching associated with that. Dr. Oakley and her team have been analyzing the interim assessments results, providing professional learning on standards that are low based on those interim assessment results. So we're responding, I think, very appropriately to the data that we're looking at right now.
Yeah. Winston?
No, you go ahead.
Okay, I'm sorry. Winston and Pat?
So following up, that's helpful for me. I want to make sure I'm sort of looking at the trend data correctly, because this diagonal piece is now what my attention is on. So am I, does that carry forward in all instances? Like when I look at, you know, math, we see there in fourth grade, page 15. So fourth grade math, you know, in 2016, two or three years ago, I don't know, is that data for what, 2015-16? So tell me when.
15-16.
So the 15-16 school year, low growth, but then something happened, right, in the next year where we had considerable growth, right, but then it dipped a little bit. So maybe we lost half that growth, but we still, over time, that blue in the middle of that diagonal line down to the right, correct, would indicate overall we had growth from 26-17 when those kids hit sixth grade in 2018. Is that, I mean, the trend line would show growth at about half that 1.4 or something, right?
You're correct. So you're just looking at it like a staircase.
Right, and sort of following the same class, right? You got to go down in a diagonal to say those 2016 kids didn't grow, then in the fifth grade they grew, and then in the sixth grade they dropped a little, but that whole trend line would have been an upward growth trend.
That's correct.
Judy Ping's looking at me like I'm crazy.
Not sure.
It depends on what the differentials are, right? So I mean, that's what I'm looking for. How do we see some of the trends overall? And I see you're saying that over to the far right. I want to understand, as opposed to just glazing my eyes over at this, I really want to understand.
Yeah, I think as we
how I see the trend.
So if you take fourth grade and go down the column, so that's really, in my opinion, that's analyzing teacher impact over the course of the year, each year with different groups of students.
With different students.
Then if you take that fourth grade in 2016, then follow it to fifth grade in 2017, and then follow it to sixth grade in 2018,
then you gotta go diagonal down,
that's
right?
Monitoring the growth of that group over a three-year time period.
Right.
And so that can tell us different things too. That can tell us, you know, obviously teacher impact as well. It can also tell us the impact of curriculum instructional resources in that grade level, the professional development that we provide. So it causes further analysis on the professional learning, on the, you know, looking at turnover rates, those kinds of things that happen over time. And then, you know, again, this is the district level, so then we break that down. Do we see trends in and amongst the schools where we've had higher turnover? So it really causes deeper analysis. So we look at it both ways. We look at it down the column and then diagonally as well, and try to analyze and problem solve around that.
So how are you and SSOs and principals using that, like, school-based data to make decisions or to change strategies or to look at, I mean, that's where the change happens, right?
Yeah, I think the real time is the interim assessments that I referred to earlier. So, you know, what we've done at the end of each cycle of each interim assessment is look at the standards where we see strengths and weaknesses. And then in the standards, and I won't get too geeky on you here, but the standards interact. So you might have one standard that shows up more in an assessment, but if you haven't addressed a prerequisite standard, like especially in math leading up to that standard, then you won't see growth on the core standard. So we have to address those at the root level through professional learning, how students are responding. Then we can look at that over time in our interim assessments. And so we've done a lot of content academies, some Saturday sessions, which have been filled up. We're doing after school sessions. We're doing specific professional learning at Title I schools, specifically around secondary schools, to address what we're seeing in real time. But then this also is support some of that we're seeing as well. So we're taking data and triangulating it and then responding to that based on the needs at each school.
Thank you.
Thank you. Winston kind of asked some of the questions I had with regard to explaining how the trends work. I guess my another question I had is, I mean, we know we've got a new math curriculum that was launched this year.
Correct.
Eureka and then Open Up. So in your experience and just in other districts and what you know, you and Dr. Penny together collectively, I mean, is that pretty normal to see when you roll out something new that you have either a flattening or, in fact, as we see, a dip?
Yeah, so this data actually reflects 17-18 scores that did not, where we did not have a full-scale rollout in math curriculum. So it's hard to say. So this is the real full year. Like, there were some pilot schools last year that did that on the math side. But I was actually just in professional learning earlier in the week in the state of Louisiana, where they've done, they've adopted as a state the very same approach that we've taken adopting high-value curriculum. Most of the schools districts there are using Eureka and Open Up, and they, in fact, did not see an implementation dip in many of their schools. So that doesn't mean we will or we won't. But they were really saying during that time that that may not necessarily be the case in all the schools, but it could be in some. So it was interesting to spend some time with superintendents and chief academic officers and working with a state that is actually, they actually pioneered the approach on this high value curriculum, and they're seeing some really great gains from a growth perspective and also from a proficiency perspective. I was at a low-income school that actually had a C letter grade from proficiency, but I had an A letter grade on growth. And they were using Eureka math at their school. So it was really interesting to see how they were coaching it, how they were doing job-embedded professional development, mm-hmm. Some of the very same things that we're doing here in Guilford County Schools.
So to add to that, as you know, we often mention when you implement new curriculum, you often see an implementation dip. I'm glad to hear that some other districts are not experiencing that. But you also have to consider curriculum will never take the place of a great teacher. Mm-hmm. So we have to continue our efforts to work with our teachers to make sure we continue the professional development, considering the fact that 58% of our first year teachers are not trained, are lateral entry teachers. Most districts do not have that sort of high percentage that is going to have some impact on the work we're doing. So it will take a lot more professional development with our teachers to make up for that high percentage of teachers. We're also working with principals to make sure that the teachers teaching eighth grade math, particularly the general math classes, the non-honors classes, are not the lateral entry teachers and are not the teachers who are not yet certified. Sometimes we have a teacher who teaches four sections of science and one section of math, and we throw them in the math class with the eighth grade general education students who are non-honor students, and that's a problem. So we've been actually pulling the credentials of the math teachers who are teaching these courses to try to make sure that students in non-honors classes are getting the very best teachers in the district.
And I just did want to follow up that to say that from a research standpoint, I would not be at all surprised if we saw an implementation dip. I would love to not see one. It would be great, but I would not be surprised to see one.
Has answered my question as well, but I would also like to add that in middle school we know that there are a lot of changes going on with children, so I just want to lift up the fact that we'd have some social emotional learning, and that's why we do need our counselors, our psychologists, and it just justifies even in the grades that we need those other supports. Teachers need those other supports, so I think that's when we might not see an implementation dip if we definitely get those other working parts that children need, especially in middle school, because that seems to be always the area where kids kind of like flatline, where there is no growth in those areas. So this definitely, the data supports that need.
I'm sorry, were you going to talk, Mrs. Bellamy? I just wanted to add, with these 9 data points over 3 years, I want to commend the schools and the teachers, because what is reported in the public is not this. It is the proficiency rates. So for the 9 data points of 7, the district exceeded growth, not met growth, but exceeded growth. And 1 they did not meet, that we have to continue to work on, and 1 we met. So that exceeded growth means we did more than exceed the expectation of where these students were supposed to be. So we have to do a better job of letting the teachers know that, given the limited resources they have with staffing, materials, that they are exceeding the statistical expectations of where they should be. And we commend the staff, the leadership, the students, the support staff in the buildings, and we thank the parents and students for all of their efforts as well.
I would throw one more accolade on there, if I may. I'll never pass up a chance to brag on our teachers and our staff. So one of the EVOS data points, two of the EVOS data points that we didn't see on here, because they're not directly related to the KPIs, is biology and English 2. So if we look at the same report for biology and English 2, for the last 3 consecutive years in both subject areas, they're exceeding growth.
All right, so there are no more questions? Dandy, if you have
one. Okay, as we look at the future, what else are you going to need to keep this going? Can you do that real short?
Yeah, I think we have to do everything we can to retain our teachers. The constant teacher turnover is very difficult for any school district. We have to continue to invest in professional learning and try to provide more professional learning where we can, and differentiate that based on where the teacher is, not provide all of them the same thing, but where are they? And what kind of professional learning do they need for the students that are sitting in their classroom? And also try to provide as many curriculum resources. The other thing is, I don't feel there are as many supports as there should be, as there are in most districts for students. We don't have robust summer programs, extended learning programs, extended day after school programs. We have some, but there's not a lot of funding. Principals do what they can. If you're a Title I principal, you have some, but other principals really don't have a lot available to them. So we just have to try to stay the course, not try to do a lot of different things, but stay focused on these, the goals we have, and to continue to focus on the current efforts of the district.
Thank you.
Thank you. So if there are no more questions, thank you, Dr. Penny.
Sure.
Mr. Schultz. Under action items on our agenda, we are at number B, operations. You received information on recommendations for a revised Board of Education meeting schedule. So we'd like to open up discussion looking at the different options. I remember during one of our retreats, we were discussing how to have efficient and effective board meetings, how we wanted to spend the majority of our time, and that we've tried to focus on our strategic plan and our KPIs, and using our board meetings for voting on those presentations and information. And we also discussed having work sessions where we would decide some issues where we would go into greater detail about. So the floor is open for discussion about the options. Option C, and I know I also suggested that it not tie up all the Tuesdays, and I recommended a Wednesday meeting once a month,
instead of just a straight Tuesday schedule like that. Oh, right, and now it's Schedule D. That's right, you did add it. Thank you so much. You know, that was my only suggestion, just tying up the Tuesdays on that level and going with a Wednesday, a different day. We've done Tuesdays and Thursdays a long time here in the district, so that's just my only suggestion. And I would like to see another budget meeting.
Yeah, we have the two in July and August to start at 4, of course, are accommodating our student reassignment sessions where we are in closed session for those earlier meetings. Other discussion? Anita?
I do not like the Wednesday meeting because my church meets on Wednesday, as do a lot of churches, and I do try to attend. But it's not about me, but it's about a large share of the community who attends church on Wednesday.
Okay. Anyone else? Byron?
Thank you, Madam Chair. There were some questions regarding with this B, C, and D, as with the works, the one that the proposals have the work sessions. I know C and D have the work session scheduled. C and D, that would the work sessions be videoed like they are now and the recordings made available? There's been some concern that all of those recordings are not available or made to the public on the website to view from previous work sessions. Someone had referenced that they couldn't find any audio from the CTE work session. So would we still have the camera and crew for a work session? So would that just be audio? And if so, then is that available on the website?
I think we would have to discuss that. I know our board set work sessions have been seasonal and random, you know, just based on certain issues that, you know, the board felt like we needed to discuss. And so I think we would have to, I don't know if Dr. Contreras, if there are any other, I wouldn't imagine there are taping issues or issues with having those sessions recorded.
I don't have any issues, so I would have to get back to the board with why we don't record work sessions, but there must be some history behind it, so okay. I don't want to speak to it.
Linda?
I'm just going to say with Kim, other than Wednesday's probably not, I like the Tuesday, Thursday, because, you know, I have things that, if I have to miss, if it's in a month and it's every week on a Tuesday, I miss one. If it's every month and or every week on a Tuesday and we have two meetings on Tuesday, I end up missing two. Now, if we don't want to do Wednesday, I like the Tuesday, Thursday. And I think also for staff that has children out there, if their children are doing ball games every Tuesday or their children are doing certain things, at least, you know, if they only have to miss one a month instead of two a month. And, you know, I do think when we had this one time before, I think I did kind of get some feel from some parents out there that are staff that were kind of happy that we weren't doing it on the same day for the same reason that I have. That I have something going on Tuesday nights, and I've had something going on Tuesday nights for several years. And if we change them all to Tuesday, then I have to miss two.
Byron?
I will go back to the, and I do respect everyone's comments. So I want to be clear. I feel that we're at a point to where what ends up happening every meeting is that we have an impromptu work session. And that we have, you know, longstanding gotten away from the core of business when we actually have a board meeting. So there are boards across the country, they come in, they call the question, they vote up or down, and then they leave. When we get into the discussion and I need the data and I won't vote without the data and all that, well, that's really getting into a work session to work out some of the bigger issues before they get to an agenda. Instead of we're just figuring out, okay, what can we support, what we can't support, and, you know, we have from the time the agenda is posted until the time we have the meeting to get our answers, questions, and I'm sure many of us feel that that's not always opportune time to get adequate responses as well as staff to pull data since we currently don't have a fully functional data system. So data's not ready, available to pull, but then we're still struggling with that process. And so I feel that by going to one a month, whether it's Tuesday or Wednesday, we actually get to the business that is the board. Keeping in mind, we still hopefully, by switching to this, the next thing we would look at is a recommendation from the policy committee to adopt Robert's Rules of Order, which will help streamline the process. And so we, if we're going to, you know, get our meeting structure looking like an actual board, then we need to have an actual officially adopted version of governance so that we can expedite the meetings, so that we can be fair to staff and constituents, but we can get the business done.
Thank you. Pat?
My only comment would be that whatever we do, and we talked about this at length together as a board with the guidance of our school partner, Michael Casterly, and so I think to focus on student outcomes, that was really what we talked about. That doesn't mean that we limit debate or limit questions. That has nothing to do with that. I think we, in full transparency, the community benefits when they hear us ask questions. And I don't suggest that we necessarily wait and do it 60-minute style and do all the questions, you know, in that regard. But as I think that's a benefit to the community, and it gets to our core, which is being fully transparent. And the media's here, and they get to hear the questions. And so there's a real benefit to discussing those issues, ever how long it takes. I don't suggest that I like four-hour meetings, I can tell you that. But if that's what it is, then that's what it is. And so whatever schedule we adopt, I just hope that, number one, it is student outcome focused. I think we've done that. I think we, with guidance and in those work sessions, we've done that. And I think, Madam Chair, you and Dr. Contreras, you all have helped to usher in that process and that efficiency. And we do need to be efficient. But I do want to just maybe caution us that, you know, having questions and hearing from our board members and that exchange of ideas, sometimes that's where really we get to a higher level, is when we hear from each board member and have those questions. And I think that's a healthy thing.
Winston?
I agree. I really like Schedule C because I like seeing the work sessions. I think one of the most dynamic discussions we've had were like the CTE work session, where we had staff at the table and we had the chamber folks at the table and we had university leaders at the table, and we could have a lot of dialogue and question. And still maintain decorum and order, but with more give and take, which the structure of the board meetings, you know, constituents speak, which is helpful, but we don't have dialogue around that. We all speak and don't have as much dialogue. So what I like about C, I guess D is similar. I also recognize churches meet on Wednesdays a lot, but is the number of work sessions where we really commit and we would know what those topics are in advance, and we would have some conversation about what the structure of that work session is, how those unfold, and could begin to really say, what do we handle in board meetings and how do we handle that so that that's happening, but how do we also do those work sessions? I would agree having them be, I mean, the media has been at work sessions, but how we make those more fully available, not just snippets that the media might. So I do like the number of retreats and the work sessions and the opportunities to do that kind of work.
On which proposal?
A C is the one that, I think C and D are very similar. It's just a different, it's Wednesday versus Tuesday sort of dominating, it looks like.
C is Tuesdays and D is Thursdays.
Wednesday. No, Wednesday.
I'm sorry.
Wednesday.
Right.
Yeah. Anita?
So,
I'm sorry, Winston, were you finished?
Yes. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Anita?
That's okay. I like A. And what I would really like to see is the staff take A and add the six work sessions in place of six of the board meetings and have some combination of, what was it, C?
A and C.
A and C? Yeah. And still have the work, not every one of these be a board meeting, but sprinkle in the work sessions.
Well, I do.
She's made a recommendation, so.
Right. Who's next?
So we're still having discussion right now.
Oh,
so Kim?
I'm thinking when it's a work session that it's because we're preparing for the board meeting. You're right, with having those discussions in the work session with the hope that we're also going to be able to prepare the agenda that we're going to vote on and that we're going to take care of the business for. Is that the idea of the work session, to have the, to bang out all of those logistics and then come to the board meeting to take care of the business?
Or are they for presentations or something like that?
Right, all of that is going to happen at a work session.
During some work, some board meetings, there are issues or presentations that need to be made that warrant in-depth conversations like a CTE or a budget.
In the work session.
Right.
Right.
So it's not having a quasi-meeting in the work session.
No.
It's when there are really important issues of rollout of an important initiative or something that you want to go more in depth in so that you understand it and feel prepared to vote on in mm-hmm. the meeting.
Right. Okay.
So the work session, as
you're thinking of them, would be around a specific topic, not necessarily, as Kim was saying, in preparation for a board meeting.
Specific topics in preparation for a board meeting.
Yeah, but
so it's not like
like
the board
work session,
meeting
board meeting,
board
work
meeting.
Session,
right.
Board meeting. That's not what you're envisioning, is it?
That's not how I am.
That's what I. No. That's what I thought. Yeah.
Linda.
All right. So we'll, you know, we have these work sessions because we have questions about things on the agenda. So if the work session doesn't touch on the issues that are concerns or questions or whatever, are we going to have additional meetings on top of the work sessions? Because, like, you know, there's been, you know, when we do things, we meet with the people when we're new in new programs or whatever, and you don't want us, you want us to try to ask as many questions beforehand so that we don't have to spend too much time here. We have a mini session kind of thing going on. All right. I like mini sessions because I like to know what I'm voting on. So if the work sessions are not going to be the mini sessions, then I'm still going to want mini sessions. Is that?
Yeah, you have the right to that. I think it's more what are items of big public interest that the vast majority of the board want to go more in depth on.
Okay, so I just want, but it doesn't take away from the,
right.
The mini, they're still gonna be there, we're still gonna, so we're really still gonna spend the same amount of time doing board business. It's just one's gonna be on a major topic, open to more discussion. The public will still be there. We don't know if we're gonna have it taped or not, but then if we have items on the agenda and I feel like I need more information, then I can there again ask to have a mini session or sit down and talk to somebody.
Correct.
Okay.
Winston?
Darling,
yeah, I'm sorry.
I was going to make a suggestion following up on Anita's, but maybe. What does matter to me is if we have work sessions, that they be recorded, videotaped. That's very important. It's important for the public to be able to see what we're saying and what we're doing. And then the other thing is just something that we probably should think about. If we're going to have a work session, I think generally we don't have public comment during that time. Is that right, usually?
Usually.
So I think then you can expect at our board meetings to have the public comment session to become longer. So just to think about.
Question about the work sessions. Do you envision those as non-voting meetings?
I think there's always the potential for the board to vote on something.
I would just caution you that, especially in the summer, you're going to have some hiring decisions you might want to make more often than
I'm just asking.
Yeah, I don't know if we can ever say we're not, when we're the board, the full board's in a session, if we're not going to vote, that there's the potential for voting is always,
okay.
Voting on something is always
good.
Meetings
and fair
meetings.
Enough.
Yeah. Winston.
So I have a suggestion, because, but I,
Jill's comment prompts me to ask a question about, C has the last board meeting on June 9th. Are there reasons for the board to meet for, that seemed inconsistent with the schedule? You were saying we may have summer hiring decisions to make, did you say that?
Mm-hmm. Well, summer? Certainly during the month of July, for example, you may have hiring things you want to vote on more frequently than once a month.
I got it, it's back up at the top, I see.
It doesn't necessarily mean in June, I'm just saying there, to get everybody in place for school starting, sometimes you might not want to just have a July 9th meeting and then not meet again until.
Jill, is there any, may I ask with that, is there any reason that the board could not do in the summer months during the work sessions, just a personnel approval?
Yes, absolutely, that's what I'm saying. I just didn't want you to say we never vote in those, because that's the kind of thing we want to vote on.
That's why I was asking.
Exactly what I anticipated.
So here's my suggestion, building on Anita's comment as well as Linda's about Tuesdays and Thursdays, which is taking, so I'm looking at proposal A, I'm making a specific recommendation. That Thursday, August 22nd be a work session, that Thursday, September 26th be a work session, Thursday, October 20th.
Wait, hold on, September 26th?
Mm-hmm, sorry, yes. Thursday, October 24th be a work session. That was three. Mm-hmm. August 22nd, September 26th, October 24th, mm-hmm. January 23rd, March 26th, and April 23rd.
Is that a motion?
And that the last two board meetings, or maybe just the last one, I guess, the June 25th board meeting be removed. So you'd go through June 9th. Okay. So it sort of, in my mind, takes the concept of this, but moves it to A, keeps the Tuesday, Thursday shift, puts as many work sessions in. It does have one more board meeting than proposal C.
Is that a motion?
I move.
May I make second. One suggestion before you do that for something you might have forgotten about? The reason there's usually an end of June meeting is because there are budget adjustments
everything
sometimes
else stays the
that
same.
Come up, and so we usually have to approve an interim budget because, and that's usually as close to the end of the month as you can get. So it is customary, Andy, that we have a meeting toward the end of June, if not the end of June, wouldn't you say? It could be a really, really short meeting. It could be a noon meeting.
Right, we had a couple of proposals minutes. That didn't have that on it, yeah, so it didn't appear that was critical.
If we had a meeting in June, I think we could go ahead and pass an interim budget resolution at a meeting in June based on the current year budget, so that we wouldn't necessarily have to have one that last week of June.
But what about budget amendments, et cetera, for your fiscal close?
Right, we've got, because the way we write our budget resolution, we have some time in early July. If we can make sure the first meeting in July, we can bring some the final amendments there. Mm-hmm. So I think we would be okay. We just would have to work to get our May budget amendments to the early June meeting. That's what we would have to do. That's where my concern would be, is getting the May budget amendments approved.
In any event, even if you needed a meeting, you could call one and it could be brief.
Kim?
I don't know what
Again, locking down, I thought that we were locking down like one day for the work session, no matter what day that we're going to choose for the work session. But my biggest concern, again, this year, having always on the Thursday, the board meeting, to be more flexible. So is there any way that 1 month the board meeting is on that Wednesday and then the other meeting is on that Thursday, or, you know, to go back and forth? I'm just saying.
I would say.
To have more flexibility, you know.
Wednesday is Bible study night for most of Guilford County. I just want to throw that out. The board could do what they want with that information, but I know a lot of families do ask us never to schedule any school events on Wednesday evening.
We have a motion and a second?
We don't have a motion.
Yes, we do.
We're discussing.
We made a motion. I think she was just making a recommendation.
I asked her specifically if that was a motion.
Winston's motion?
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that it was a motion.
No, I didn't hear that.
I said yes, but I'm willing to withdraw if staff needs to review it. I understand there are a lot of moving parts, but all of those meetings were on one of the proposals. That's why. I didn't add any new dates. I relabeled existing dates.
I really didn't even write down what you said, so. Because my biggest concern.
Because this is Tuesdays and Thursdays. It doesn't have a Wednesday.
No, I get that, but what day did you initiate the work session?
Right here.
Most of the work sessions are on, they're all on a Thursday.
No, the first one you said, I think, was Tuesday.
I think it's Thursday, the 22nd.
No, Thursday, August 22nd.
You said Thursday, the 25th.
I marked the wrong one.
Thursday, August 22nd.
Okay, what proposal are you looking at?
So the work sessions are always on a Thursday, but there are also some board meetings on Thursday. That's all. So yes, that's how it played out. I was building off one of the records.
I think Winston's making a motion recommendation, making a recommendation, and Kim is asking for clarity on that. So what are you asking for, Byron?
For a point of order, when we started with our retreats and with our process and working with the Council of Greater City Schools, we had serious conversation dialogue about voting up or down the superintendent's recommendations. I'm not writing those dates down because they have not been processed through staff and made available for me to view. So if we're going to piece together another option, then the superintendent and her staff should be directed to go back and actually vet this proposal, and we table this to the next meeting, not up here writing on the back of paper, trying to piece together a resolution. We agreed to that structure in that retreat, and we need to uphold what we said we would do regarding motions and recommendations from the superintendent.
I don't know if we voted to do that. I know those were recommendations to us. I think we're having some discussion so that the staff will have greater clarity.
I didn't give up three Saturdays and four.
I think I said before you spoke, Byron, that I was happy to withdraw if it.
Byron.
If it needed.
Byron, Byron.
I said earlier I was willing to withdraw if staff needed to.
Hold on, just a minute.
Oh, my Lord.
Hold on, Byron.
You may speak now.
So I said earlier, before Byron spoke, that if this needed to be vetted through staff because there were so many moving parts, I would withdraw the motion so that that could happen. I stated that earlier. Thank you.
So we're having some discussion on the recommendation so that staff can go back and look at those. Kim?
Yeah, I just need them to go back and put what she proposed, because my biggest concern, a work session usually would come before a board meeting, and it sounded like that wasn't happening, so I wasn't sure what she said. And like I said, I didn't write it down because I wasn't going to vote on it anyway.
So I do have one question, clarifying question. Does that mean, Mrs. McGregor, that the other Thursday meeting, are you proposing keep the other Thursday meeting or throw out the other Thursday meeting? I wasn't clear on that point.
Yeah,
I'm fine for you to take my notes and then for you all to work through staff comments.
Come up with some.
Right, I mean.
No, we want Tuesday, Thursdays, and the work sessions worked on the Tuesday, Thursdays.
No, we know what you want.
Okay.
Just be clear, we're having a discussion about what we all want.
Okay.
So everyone will have the same opportunity to put in what they want to suggest.
Okay.
And bring it back.
So there's a proposal to.
Correct, so I'm.
For A, with the modification.
I'm happy for them to take this and incorporate other feedback, which is what I said.
So you would, so one of the options you would like for us to work on is the Tuesdays, the Thursdays with the work sessions, but there are some other Thursdays there. What I'm unclear on is the other Thursdays, do they come off or are they board members?
So my personal recommendation, which may be different than my colleagues, was this, that the Thursday meetings stay.
I'll bring something back and you all.
But others may have other specific recommendations.
So. Any other recommendation?
Kim and then Byron. My recommendation is concern about student assignment and is there any way that we can schedule those dates already? So that way parents will know what days that those appeals are going to be done ahead of time. as opposed for us waiting to schedule those days if there is an appeal? Like, I want to know what my summer is going to look like to do that kind of work.
I think one of our challenges has been we've had a number of appeals that might go past a deadline, and we have to pull one together, and then it depends on board member availability to
Well, that's what I'm trying to alleviate that. Let us set some dates now for the purpose of doing that, and then I set my calendar that I'm available
and that
on
may
that
change.
Day.
Those may change.
Okay, wait a minute.
Do we have a director of student assignment yet? Because
we probably need that first.
Well, even whenever we get one, that may change simply because we might be inundated, and we have all depending on how many hearings we can hear during a day, and then how many we can get through in a board meeting. If we can't get through any in a board meeting, even if we have a set schedule, we'll have to schedule another board meeting to handle the requests that we haven't been able to get to approve as a body.
Okay, so in the past, I mean, we kind of know what that looks like, right? Like, what those days are going to look like. Like, I would like us to set aside, if it's 3 days I need to be available to handle that business, I want to know what 3 days we are proposing in July or June or whenever that is going to start. But we need some real
timeline. It's all
timeline.
July and August.
Huh?
They're usually all week, all month.
So we don't have a policy where we're done with that by?
No, because it all depends on the request that we get in.
So we're at the mercy of the request.
Okay.
With the parental request, that's what we open up to our community, that people can request and, you know, a request of reassignment.
Up until what day?
Up until probably before, or shortly before, what has traditionally been
the policy? I don't remember. I think it's June 15th, but I honestly don't remember the deadline.
Right. They have until June 15th to make the request.
Right.
And then how much time do we give?
You will have up to 600. So it depends on how they get scheduled. They can be anywhere from 300 to 600 appeals.
I get that. That's why I want to know the days I need to set aside to be available now, so that we don't keep getting this email, oh, who's available? Who's available? Tell me now what day you need me to be available so I can plan to be there.
Yeah, we don't have the appeals yet. What we can do is give you what we've got in the past to say that the appeals traditionally have started on this day and have ended around here. So we can do a projection. We just can't really say because it varies.
No, it should not be at the availability of the parent. You have to tell the public, the parent, when we're available to do it, because if it's that important, they're going to make sure they're there to do the appeal. We have to be very specific in our planning, even for doing appeals, right? Because I would love to be in New York for the summer, okay? That's the real deal. But I'm elected to do this work and to do the business. So I want student assignment to give me my days that they want Kim Irby available to handle student appeals.
So I think what they can do is just give you a schedule. Right now, we don't have any appeals, so we can't. We know when we start scheduling them. So what we can let you know is when we have started scheduling the appeals panels, and then it depends on how many board members can come. Mm-hmm. Because you might be able to show up and nobody else. And so we have a 3-member panel of the board. We've been able to do them with at least 2. But there are some we can't do at all.
But if we set the calendars now, the board members will set their calendars to be available on those days.
Okay, well, I think we can give you that. It's just subject to change. Work, okay. People's work schedules, all kind of things are subject to change. So if we can ask the superintendent to give us a trend or a projection on the time frame that we start hearing student appeals, both as panels and then as the full board, that'll be probably helpful.
Thank you.
I would like to ask you to look into something else, too. I like Proposal C, but would like to alternate Tuesdays and Thursdays on C, yes. Proposal C. And I know that as we were talking with our Vice Chair Bellamy Smalls, that this includes having the rotation for meetings in High Point. So even though we might have fewer meetings, that we will continue to meet in High Point.
You want to see where they are.
Yes, so the High Point meetings, yes. And if we could alternate Tuesday, Thursday on Proposal C. Mm-hmm. Any other recommendations?
I'm sticking to my example.
Okay, Byron?
I was going to say, to the student reassignment point, that we should go with two instead of the three. I think it was three because we were at 11 and we never changed that. And so can we officially go to two people to hear those initial?
I think it was more than that. I think if there are three people and somebody's sick, that at least leaves two. If you have two people and somebody's sick, that'll leave one person. So.
Procedures or your policy, I can't tell you off the top of my head, and it probably does need to be amended.
Yeah, the policy does need to be amended.
But I don't remember whether it's in policy or procedure of the superintendent. Maybe, I just don't remember.
It was policy.
Student assignment hearings. I just think if we're down to two and something happens, an emergency, then that would just be one person.
But with three, we're in limbo trying to get a third one.
We've done them with two.
Okay.
We've done them with two plenty of times. I just think if we go to two,
we don't. The law allows no fewer than two. So you can do them in two panels of two. We did three because we used to have 11 people, and because it was more likely that you got a representative feeling of the board if you had more than two of 11. But your whatever your policy or procedure says can be amended, and it can be and should be, considering you only have nine people.
Jill, could you also look at the law to see if the board could assign that, delegate that task, and then just vote on it?
They don't have to. Every student assignment can be appealed to the full board and cannot be delegated to a panel. It stems from the old desegregation times when the legislature was concerned that you could set up small panels that would resegregate schools. And so that is the only decision that the board makes that they cannot hear by panels. Make the final decision.
Because the other large districts don't do it that way.
Well, they may approve it in a slate.
They have staff panels and the board votes.
So you're talking about staff panels.
Well, yeah, the board can vote. A staff can do the first hearing. You don't have to have a panel. You have to have a full board vote.
Right, I agree. Okay. But I'm saying the board doesn't have to sit through 600 hearings.
So what you're saying, she's saying staff panels versus board panels.
All of this to the board. The board does not have to sit through 600 hearings. They don't do that in the other districts.
They don't have to do that. They can't do that.
Again, as a panel, it's like another panel. So we really sit through 1,200.
Right. In the other districts, the board sits through the final step.
Yes.
Not the first step. Right.
Linda?
I have a problem because a lot of times the decision's based on, for me, hearing the appeal and the reasoning for the appeal from the parent, from the child, my thing will be, you don't need my vote because I won't know anything different. It will already be determined by the staff. And if I don't have additional information, what am I going to argue with?
So then I would ask, what happens to the rest of those board members that don't are not on that three-person panel? It's still the same issue.
But the when that happens, you usually ask whoever's on the board, why did you vote that way? What was the reasoning for doing what you did? What did the parent say? What did the child say? You know, sometimes we go, oh, it was a horrible situation. It was a horrible story.
So could we do the same thing with the staff?
You would do the same.
Even though
with
we wouldn't be on the panel to hear the hardship, the staff would be there to hear.
Well, then I don't need to be, I don't need to be there because I'm not going to reverse a decision. Well, I guess you're saying the staff will come in there and say that, but I think I'm giving up my responsibility, but that's Linda Wellborn, and then, I'm one vote.
So the policy committee can come back and make recommendations on, is that where that would go? That the policy committee, about student appeals and student assignment decisions and product protocols and processes. So if you could look at best practices and see what's efficient, effective, equitable, Winston. Is that okay with everyone? To get some recommendations on what's done in districts of our size and what seems to be the best practice in a contemporary time.
Just be aware that the only thing you can't remove is an appeal to the full board.
So parents have the right to appeal to the full board. So we may on occasion get some of those if we change our policy.
Well, that's what you're hearing when you hear the
staff reports. I hear you.
Staff.
Right.
That is
right. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Okay. Gotcha. So right now, to wrap this up, we have, board members have given their recommendations or preferences around the options that have been offered to the superintendent. And the superintendent will go with staff and look over those and come back with how they've been able to synthesize all those.
Right. I have three options. I want to make sure that's it.
Is it possible for us to eliminate the ones that are present that we're not going to consider again so that we can, we're not going A through D or A through E?
Well, I think if she has three, she's going to consider the three.
Right. That's what I'm considering.
So maybe they're eliminated by prioritizing these.
The ones that have already been presented, because I didn't agree to that. So who, and there was no motion made. So that's just, we're just working that list. Right. That would be in addition to the options that are already present.
Well, these were.
No one made them. Yeah. So I'm saying if we can eliminate the ones that we know absolutely not going to work by vote, that way we're reducing that list instead of coming back with this list plus those three, because we didn't eliminate and we didn't vote to direct her just to review those three.
Well, we did. But if you're saying that you have another preference, we're not voting on it. We are making a recommendation. Right now, this was a recommendation, so instead we don't have one to vote on, so we were asking them to take them back. So do you have a preference? Do you want to give it to her in writing, or do you want to talk about it, what your preference would be? And then she'll go with those instead of revisiting, bringing these back and those. So what modifications would you like either to the four that are in here or a new one?
Well, I'm fine with C, but in our official capacity, we have not directed her to do specifically anything. So, I mean, we've turned this into a work session about a work session.
No, what we're doing is having a discussion, Byron.
Well,
so the discussion is that if you'll take those back and then based on the input that you've received from the board members and then come back with a new set of recommendations.
I'm just wanting to get clarity, Madam Chair. Are we still considering the current ones that are posted online, or now we now saying and need to vote to just go with the ones that she just has on the list? It looks like we just added three more on top of the other options we have.
Okay, my understanding is that we have. My understanding is that I just asked board members if there are preferences, if there's some things that you support on what's already been submitted, or if you have another preference to submit that.
And
then those will be our focus or our priority. And we can vote on that if we need to.
And Mr. Gladden, you said you want us to continue to consider Proposal C as is.
As is.
Okay.
Proposal
so
C as is.
These three and Proposal C as is will come back.
Okay.
Is that all right with everybody? All right. So we have a closed session. Jill, will we need to come back in open session and make take any action?
No. I don't believe
so. So can we do board member comments now so that people can go do what they need to do? All right. Can we start with Darlene?
I want to thank all the Page Pirates that came out tonight. To advocate for Paige. We didn't get support tonight, but we're going to keep trying. We're not going to give up because what's right is right. Commitment was made, and you deserve a cafeteria that will handle your students so they don't have to sit on the floor. I would think anybody on this board would see that. And because the commitment was made, we should honor that commitment. I also wanted to say just how sad I am about Sincere Davis. He was a great kid, and it's just such a tragedy in my heart. Goes out to his family, and it's the worst nightmare any parent ever has to face, and I'm so sorry, and I know it's hurting the Page community as well, so just want to say so sorry about that. My heart aches about it. Also, we've lost a number of really good people in GCS, and that is very concerning. In particular, Doyle Craven, Director of Student Assignment. He has worked for Guilford County Schools for many years. He worked very hard, man of integrity,
he was a stickler to following the policy. And a person of his integrity will be very hard to replace. And I'm just very concerned. I'm very concerned for this board. I'm very concerned for our students. And it sounds tonight like the board wants to relinquish their responsibility to hear student assignment cases. I personally believe that is a responsibility that we owe our families. And to not take that on because it's too inconvenient for us, because we have to sit on panels. Hey, I bet you I've been on more panels than anybody on this board. But so what? You know, it's part of my responsibility. I take it seriously. And the parents, they expect us to listen and to be concerned and to be empathetic. And that's what we need to be as a board. We should not be shirking our responsibilities. One more person I want to mention, I know I'm forgetting someone, but is Gerald Greason. That man worked tirelessly for this district. He gave of his heart and his soul, and he did everything he could to, on the small amount of funds he was given every year, to keep our schools running as best as he could. And he is such a big loss, and I am so sorry that he felt like the need to retire early. So I do want to thank him for his service, and just know that it's going to be really difficult for Guilford County Schools to replace him. So hopefully you're out on a golf course somewhere, Gerald. We love you.
Thank you, Byron.
Thank you. There's been a lot of death happening in the past 7 days, and so I definitely want to uplift the families and these students, the students who have passed away that were Parkland survivors, the students here locally, Sincere Davis, killed by gunshot, James Curry, recently Dudley Panther, who was shot just a few days ago, and other countless young people who have been killed, who have been, death by suicide or by illness or sickness. It is very real in a very real time. And so to please keep those families lifted. Hopefully we won't have any more, death coming more, but I don't know, we have to leave that in God's hands. I did want to respond to Paige, the family and parents who came out on tonight. I went and pulled the May 2008 bond referendum that the Guilford County Board of Education adopted on December 4th, 2007. And Paige High School received $2,075,000 funding to improve athletic facilities. I checked the video, and there was not an overwhelming protest of the cafeteria needs in 2007. So early there was made mention about the intention of the bonds. The bonds that were passed in 2008, the projects and the scopes were listed as recommendations and potentials when that bond was passed. And we have done right by that funding, as well as the additional funding with level of funding with capital needs. But $2 million Paige received in 2007, there was not an organized protest or an overwhelming response to tell the board no. As it relates to the promise that I'm hearing about between the board chair, who's no longer a part of the board, and as well as to the superintendent cannot be directed by individual board members. That is our policy. If board members feel strongly about issues and action items ranging from capital needs to MWBE, it takes 5 board members to move the superintendent in an official capacity to do anything. I want that to be very clear. So if it doesn't happen, then you could not count to 5, period. Also, as it relates to our ever ongoing process with learning and developing, I will say this about student assignments, because I was not properly or went through orientation when I came on this board, and to understand that every week I am sent out a schedule, regardless of work schedule or commitments, I am sent out a schedule of meetings ranging from 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning till, I think, 4 or 4:30 in the afternoon. And then to pick those schedules and juggle commitments that have been made weeks and months in advance. It is not about shirking the responsibility. Now, for some board members who want to play nepotism and want to advocate for certain parents for their children to bypass the traditional assignment process, Page, Grimsley, and other schools like that, then of course it is a concern and a duty that we take. But I want to be very clear about the process. Our current process is that we do double work. When parents appeal to the school board to hear reassignment panels, we can convene the full board, hear the case at that time, and make the decision. What we are doing is having many panels of three board members, which the entire board can override. I don't care how well that story was said. I don't care about the what you witnessed in that one-on-one panel. If you can't count to five on this board, it doesn't matter. And so we are doing duplicate work. There are board members that actually have full-time jobs and are not full-time board members. And so with respect, we heard a lot about, you know, Bible study, but when it comes to panels, we are shirking and running from our responsibilities. I fail to disagree and feel that's hypocritical to say so. We have a right to pass policy, we have a right to pass procedure and do what's best for kids. And you know what? We've been failing at that for 20 years. But I don't hear the passion about we need to do something now. I don't hear that passion about children who are graduating and not being able to read and write their own name. I don't hear that. I hear about privileged parents that want to push up on board members to make it happen for student reassignment. Let's talk about the nepotism of passing student reassignments because I know him or we golf together. Not about what actually happened. It is, and I am speaking. So when it comes to that, when it comes to that, we have an issue. And Darlene, you're leaving the board, so it really doesn't matter. So what I'm saying is this, and I will close. We have work to do, and we need to do it with respect and own our stuff and get it together.
Thank you. Kim. This morning, unfortunately, I heard the testimony of Betsy DeVos, our Secretary of Education, which I want to go on record to say that she is just, that appointment is an insult to every educator. And I just want to you to know that I apologize for what I heard her say about funding and where money should go out of the public school system. It is egregious that we have someone in office because of it's their friend. So it comes from the top, an example of the top of people and their authority and what is happening and what the bottom line really should be. And I was angered by watching her make excuses that I have to do something. I don't know what it is I'm going to organize and do about that, but I definitely feel that I'm committed to doing something about that, because there's no way that we should have someone who is not qualified as an educator in charge of education in the United States. So I came to this meeting with that on my mind. That's why I take very serious this work. It's important work for me. I'm a mother of six children, and I have to say, I had to find a way to maneuver the largest school system in New York City. And I have to tell you that we are on the right track with the programming that we're doing in Guilford County. With the CTE model, we're giving more choice. Kids are going to choose schools because they want to be there. They're not, we're eliminating the fact that I have to go to a zone school. We're giving them those opportunities. So I'm hoping that the hearings will not be as much this year
because the kids are going to be making those choices of going where they want to go. And the more we do that, we're going to see where we won't need all of these appeal hearings. I've never been a part of a school system where we don't have something in place where there's a set time that you can appeal, and then there's a set time that a child has to be in their school before school opens. There's no reason why we can't regulate that and put a rule in place. And as a parent, I would have to comply. I would have to comply. If it's not a transportation hardship, your child is going to that school. Don't put a school on your application that you know you don't want to go to. So I'm hoping that this process is going to eliminate a lot of the appeals and that our students are going to be able to access the schools where they really want to show up in the morning because they're excited about what's going to be happening for them in that school building. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to a lot of good things over the summer for kids, and I'm hoping that we realize that it's not just the responsibility of the school board, that we have other elected bodies in the city that can help, you know, alleviate what is going on in our communities. It should not just be the burden of Guilford County Schools to solve all the problems with safety, solve all the problems that are happening in our communities. And I'm hoping that we can work with other legislative bodies, our city officials, and continue to work with the county commissioners as well to deal with these ills and these things that are happening to our children that are in our communities. We have to extend and look for other sources and resources to reach out to solve some of the things that are happening in our communities. Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to explain my no vote on the support for a Rebuild America School Act. I absolutely want all of our children in state-of-the-art schools, schools that are designed and built for enrichment and excitement, absolutely. And I know as I've looked at the zip codes in the city of Greensboro, that the zip codes line up with socioeconomic status, which impacts graduation rates and bachelor's degree attainment. Zip codes 27455, 27408, and 27410 that are 72 to 81% white have the lowest poverty levels. They have the highest median home value and the highest income per capita. They have the highest graduation rates and they have the highest attainment of a bachelor's degree or more. So the socioeconomic opportunities, I live in a census tract in Greensboro, 112, that is experiencing hyper-segregation and intense poverty. And so that the economic opportunities that would be available through the Rebuild America Schools Act must be distributed in ways that people can benefit from that, because the schools are having to address so many non-academic needs that families that live in these census tracts and hyper-segregation and hyper-poverty are compounded by all of the other social determinants, not having access to food and transportation and labor and employment opportunities and safe and affordable housing and all of those things. And these, you know, food deserts, I think, are just looking at food deserts as an independent issue. Also, diffuses the issue in many ways, because if it's food deserts are largely in communities where there are low performing schools, so it's an education desert, where there is low employment, so it's an employment desert, transportation, housing, healthcare, all of those things. And so I hope that we put processes and protocols in place so that another $1 billion isn't spent in Guilford County schools and little to none of that money goes into communities that should have an opportunity to thrive and survive. Thank you.
Winston?
A lot going on here. So I started my morning at Irving Park Elementary, and I want to say thanks to the teachers and all of the volunteers. And a kind of funny thing happened. I read to this amazing class, had a great time, went back downstairs, and Principal Nagley from Page was late, probably had some critical things to deal with. He was going to read to a class. They weren't sure he was going to get there. And so they asked if I would read to another class. I said, yep, I'd be happy to do it. So Camden, this adorable third grader, comes to get me to take me to the class, and as we're walking on the breezeways, and was pleased to see entry cards and locked doors and lots of what looked like some new securing of that campus in place, he said, I think my class is going to be pretty disappointed with you. And he's like, Principal Nagley was supposed to read to our class. And I was like, okay, I'm going to do my best. And he's like, really? I think it's going to be a problem. Anyway, I got to the class. It was a little bit of a problem. They were not very excited to see me, and they had the Page fight song up on a video, and they were all ready to go. But I did my very best, everything but stood on my head, and I think I won them over by the end. But there were a lot of volunteers making that happen. There are a lot of volunteers across the district. I appreciate the focus on that this morning. And there was a lot of good things happening inside that school building, and just want to shout out. I've had an opportunity to be in a lot of school buildings over the last several weeks, from Fraser to Page to Mendenhall to Peck, schools in High Point. This is a vast district, and one of the things that happens in this slow constraining of resources that's happened over the last decade at the state level and at the federal level is it pits us against one another. So Page clearly has cafeteria needs. I think we also spent almost the whole district's furniture budget this past summer to try and address some of that, but it's still a problem. They are pulling tables out. There isn't enough room to eat. But there's critical issues at Northwest. There's critical issues at Joyner. There were critical issues really across the district. And in this constrained environment, it pits us against one another. And it works. It works for the folks who want to see us do that. How we deal with these individual issues and set priorities is critical. So I appreciate the advocacy when parents show up, when teachers show up, when board members express their support for specific schools and initiatives. I think it's important. I was also in Raleigh this week with the two chambers advocating to our state legislature. I think Darlene and Linda were both there. There may have been others that I didn't see. Because we have really got to take this to the legislature and continue to fight for increased resources, and we're going to need to do it at the local level and solve some tough problems at the local level. We're going to need parents who are advocating for their schools to help us look at how we finance infrastructure and facilities, and we're going to have to come together in creative ways to do that. I wholeheartedly support the teachers and the classified employees in the May 1st action, and look forward to what we can do to support the teachers, because I think we do have to really show solidarity and fight for the resources that we need to resolve these issues across the district. And the reason that I support CTE comes back to the kids this morning and the kids I've interacted with and the data that Dr. Penny presented with Dr. Dawson. Seeing how that CTE was changing the achievement gap and changing outcomes for students of color, in particular in ways where lots of things we have tried or think we'll do that aren't, was very compelling. And I think while we do have to invest in new things and moving forward, while we balance that against these just really untenable choices. So I appreciate that that's hard. People are gonna get emotional or angry or seek data that really makes a point, and these discussions at board meetings and in work sessions as we dive in will be really important. So I want to let Principal Nagley know on camera that I told that class he was going to bring them donuts one day. So I will email him and let him know. I kind of set him up because they were really disappointed with me. In fact, all the questions they asked me about why did Principal Nagley become a principal and what does he do all day, they had zero questions for what a Board of Education member does. So thanks. Linda.
I'm going to try to cut to the chase because there's lots of legislation going on. Everyone knows that we have children in subpar learning environments, that we need innovative schools to excite children about attending them. And so the Rebuild America School Act is an opportunity at the federal level. The state level is also looking at
$2 billion.
There's a bill in the state level. So, you know, everybody knows that. And so I'm hoping somewhere along the line, we're gonna get some funding for our schools because it is desperately needed. I do wanna say thank you to our local delegation who is really up there fighting for us. Whether it be John Hardister, Ashton Clemens, Michael Garrett, Amos Quick, and I'm going to have to name them all now, Gladys Robinson, Tillman, yeah, Jerry Tillman. They're all really working hard for us, and even, Fairclough, thank you. Pricey, all right. But anyway, they're, and Cecil Brockman. But my point is that I have not seen our delegation pulled together in, for Guilford County like they are with this delegation. They did, even though me and Senator Tillman sometimes spar when it comes to some things, there are certain issues that we just can't get along on, but I want to give him a big shout out because he really went to bat for us in the Education Committee on our CTE funding. And I'm all about giving people credit, and I think he was the one. And also, like I said, our general delegation at the House level, which was Quick and Clemens and Hardister, really pulled it through it there. So we've got some hardworking legislators up there, and I'm very proud of them right now. They're working on the K-3. They're working on the performance, grades. They're working on a calendar, and there's a lot going on at state level, and we'll try to home you in as we can, but right now we're kind of sorting through all of this. With that said, I've got some exciting news. Go Lady Falcons! 3A Go Lady Falcons! 3A championship. We're very excited for them. That was very, and I also want to give a shout out to the Southwest boys. Also, both our teams on the 3A made state championships. So that's a great ending.
Thank you, Pat.
That is a great ending. Hopefully I can have a great beginning. Just want to lift up and echo really what Board Member Welburn mentioned about the legislature, and we touched on it in the last board meeting, so I won't get into some of those details. But we do really have a very robust spirit of bipartisanship in Raleigh, and that only benefits all of us. And I think what has happened over the years institutionally in Raleigh is, you know, who's ever in the leadership, for years it was Bass Night, and there was a lot of activity and money, right? That's what that means, going to the eastern part of the state. And that was all well and good, but there was very little back then that made its way to the Triad. So now you have a lot of people in key leadership positions that are from the Triad, namely Guilford County. So what we have seen and will see is more of that effort, and I think more dollars. So that's very encouraging. And I do want to lift up the Page families tonight, and every family that comes before this board and addresses us from the podium. I think it's very counterproductive if we were to in some way pick schools and say, well, you can come and speak, and well, you got this and you didn't get this. That is not productive at all. In fact, that's dangerous, and that tears at the fabric of the community and at the schools and at the communities. I mean, in my limited time here in 2+ years, it's been very informative to hear from communities across the district. So I really hope we'll refrain from that kind of philosophy. And I know that just let the better nature of our angels come through and support all of our families and listen, and then create policies and make actionable requests a reality. And Page is no different. And it doesn't matter what school is in front of us. If they have an issue, we need to be listening. That's why we were elected, and that's something I will do every time I have an opportunity, and I'm sure everybody else will too. Thank you.
I had an opportunity to watch the Southwest game. It was televised, and they really did a good job. And on the basketball note, go Heels tomorrow. I want to praise and give a shout out to all of our staff. They did a superb job at the Choice Showcase. I mean, you know, those folks did their regular day and then came to set up and do all of that. And I mean, if I was going back to school again, it would be hard to make a choice about which school, because everybody, I walked around the whole facility. And I mean, I really liked the experience you had for the kindergartners with the bus, and then the cafeteria action. I thought that was, you know, really a good way to help parents, and they did participate. I mean, those little kids, you should have seen them trying to step up on that bus, you know, and looking all around like, oh my gosh, this big bus. So I want to just, you know, our staff works extremely hard. Congratulations to Fairview for having the 102nd anniversary celebration of the school, which was created in 1917. We had a good participation. A lot of staff came back, so it was very important to that community to be able to come and be a part of Fairview and the good things that are happening at Fairview. I did get a chance to attend the elementary all chorus, and as you know, being a musician, they were superb, and they were so excited. When I can see young people who are excited about making music, and we do a good job of encouraging our young people to participate, and it was a quality program at Smith High School. I want to thank the Greensboro Symphony Guild for 41 years of doing the symphony for our kids. And I can tell you, I don't know who got the word out, but the children this year were much more well-behaved than last year, and they really listened to the concert, and then they had spoken word with Josephus there. And so the combination of spoken word and symphony was very creative, and I think we want to thank them and all of the sponsors for the symphony series. To the Page and Dudley families, and to all of our families who have to deal with loss, I don't know exactly what it's going to take for us to stop the killing. But, you know, somehow or another, we've got to figure this out. Because no child who hasn't even really begun to live their life should be cut down at 17 and 18 years old. So it's got to be a community effort. We got to get these guns out of the hands of folk who don't responsibly know what to do with them. My heart goes out to both the Page and Dudley families. I want to thank the Greater High Point partners. On yesterday, we had the monthly meeting, and we've got to give kudos to High Point Central. Dr. Nixon Green was there and made an excellent presentation about Central High School and the accomplishments of Central High School, and Dr. Contreras, didn't she get another award for excellence at Central? Yes. And so we want to say thank you very much for all the hard work. I don't see how any of our folk keep the enthusiasm that they do keep with the hard work that they have to do, but I mean, she was just so excited to present what's happening at High Point Central, and it made me feel proud. We want to keep that kind of enthusiasm and energy as we move forward. And I did make sure that every one of the, because we had a record number of people who attended this meeting yesterday, and I made sure that every one of them had the information about the new signature high schools and the signing up for the showcase. I mean, I passed out about, How many pieces of paper did you give me? About 10, 50? Okay, but it was, you know, anyway, I did spread the information around because it's important to me that they know that we're on point with getting the job done for the education of our children. And then my final thing is that the middle college at GTCC High Point was also there, and they're asking for volunteers for their 21st Century Skills Day, which is scheduled for April the 18th from 12 until 5 o'clock, and they want folks to come to help them with speed interviewing, basic car maintenance, financial literacy, and independent living, and there'll be a cultural fair. So they wanted the community to know that they are doing this for the students at the GTCC Middle College in High Point. So if there's anybody interested, they can of course, call Dr. Harris, who is the principal there, and lend their service to it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anita.
When enough is said, I'll pass.
Okay.
Thank you. Do you have a motion?
If we go into closed session to preserve the attorney-client privilege.
Get a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we're going into closed session, and it's not anticipating that we'll have any action when we return from closed session. Okay, we'll just come out to it.